Good morning, everybody, and can I welcome all of you to the first meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2016, and also wish everybody a very happy new year. Our first meeting of the new year is to look at BBC Charter Renewal. Before we do that, can I remind everybody to make sure that all electronic devices are switched off, because they can interfere with the sound system. Our first item is to take evidence on the BBC Charter Renewal, as I just mentioned, and can I welcome to the committee Professor Robert Beveridge, Professor Neil Blain and Professor Philip Schlesinger. Unfortunately, Dr. John McCormick has sent his apologies, is unable to be with us this morning. I'm going to move straight into questions, if you don't mind, and we're going to begin the questioning with Colin Beattie.
Looking at the broad thrust of the submissions that have been made to this committee, there's a clear feeling that the present structure of governance isn't adequate to what is required now. And indeed, there's mention made a number of times of some sort of federal structure. What would the pros and cons of a federal structure be? Where would the advantages come and where would the disadvantages come to Scotland?
Yeah. On governance, first of all, I think it's worth making the sort of the macro level point, perhaps, that at present, perhaps one of the reasons that broadcasting has been discussed, I think over the last, probably not an exaggeration to say, 25 years or so in Scotland, sometimes in a manner which hasn't greatly altered, is that the responsibility for broadcasting still lies in Westminster with DCMS, and it's therefore been possible to have this Parliament has welcomed, for example, the Scottish Broadcasting Commission report in 2008, follow-up report for the Digital Network Panel in 2011. And I suppose when you ask about governance, the first question is whether it would be helpful where the BBC... and we're having to imagine the future of the BBC a little bit just now, because we don't quite know, for example, too far into the future what the funding mechanism is going to be. But it would be helpful if the BBC were directly answerable, perhaps to this committee or to another, to an appropriate committee at Holyrood, which I think would enable us to discuss these matters in Scotland in a different way from what has happened before. You ask about a federal structure. I think in my own paper, and I want to say, I mean, I regard myself as a BBC loyalist. I think probably all of us here regard the BBC as an enormous asset, both UK-wide. It's an enormous asset in Scotland. I've expressed scepticism in my own submission about how the BBC might move to a federal structure. What I've been trying to do, and I hope I'm not trying to digress from your question here, but I think it's quite important, or I would like to put the argument out there that it might be more helpful not to wrap up the whole of the question about the future development of Scottish broadcasting in an envelope marked BBC Charter Review or Future of the BBC. I wouldn't like to take it for granted that the future development of Scottish broadcasting rests on the ability of the BBC to achieve cultural change, for example, in the direction which you indicate. I mean, it's interesting that the move to Salford, which is a very substantial and expensive move, doesn't seem to have resulted in observations, or it has not prevented the continuation of observations from the north of England, from Scotland and from elsewhere, to the effect that the BBC still seems rather London-centric. So I think, I don't want to answer your question with a question, but I think there is a question, which is how would the BBC achieve a federal structure? Does it actually want to? What would that mean? And I think among the attached questions are, if it's more likely to appear in a federalised form in Scotland, what implications would that have for example, the north of England? Because it seems improbable that the BBC could adopt, as it were, a limited federal model in one part of the United Kingdom. So I would be left rather speculating about the form that would take. I think the important thing is that Scotland really ought to have at least one television channel with editing and commissioning authority in Scotland. I mean, Ireland has, including the Irish language channel, six. We have one, BBC Alpa. In Catalonia, there are half a dozen. Ireland has six, actually, from last Saturday when Ulster TV started broadcasting something called Ulster UTV Ireland. Now, these channels have a difficult existence. I mean, RTE, TVC, and so on in Ireland have to struggle for revenue. But I think we're in a very, very different position in Scotland. So I'm answering your question in a complicated way, but I think what I would like to say is that I'm not absolutely certain that the solution to Scottish broadcasting is a federal BBC. It might be. And if the BBC culturally and in terms of revenue were capable of running an autonomous a channel with editing and commissioning autonomy in Scotland, I'd be delighted. But I feel as though I might, you know, we might wait for a long time for that to happen.
My view is that we should have a federal structure. It may be more appropriate, however, to speak of devolution max for the BBC rather than federalism. I mean, you yourselves know about the evolving relationship between the Scottish Parliament and the Westminster Parliament and the strengths and weaknesses of that relationship. And I'm convinced that were there to be a federal BBC, the same kind of problems would be encountered. But from my perspective, BBC Scotland needs to be not the BBC in Scotland, but it needs to be BBC Scotland or more of a Scottish BBC. You ask about a downside. Maybe one of the downsides in that new settlement would be that London might be even less inclined to put programmes made in Scotland on the UK network. But at the moment, as we know, River City has massive investment and it's not shown on the BBC British network. And that's not value for money. And while I personally am not a great fan of River City, it seems to me that it should be on the BBC network and Scotland should be portrayed to the rest of the UK in a much better way, and I believe a federal structure would help to bring that about.
Okay. Professor Schlesinger?
I think federalism has become a bit of a slogan, and really the key thing is to have decentralisation of the BBC under whatever name. I do think that Scotland needs to have much more control over expenditure, over commissioning, and over strategy. I do think if there's to be a debate about the decentralisation of the BBC, it's certainly helpful if a push comes from Scotland, but it's a conversation that would also necessarily involve people in Northern Ireland, Wales, certainly in the north of England. I don't think that, if you like, one set of requests is going to hack it. I think it's a much wider debate. I don't think that federalism in a formal sense is going to come about before the federalisation of the United Kingdom, and the United Kingdom has been notoriously bad at sorting out its constitutional arrangements. So I wouldn't get too hung up on that. I think the question is much more one about decentralisation. I think the downside is one in which there might be an overall loss of strategic purpose inside the BBC. I think that the BBC's culture itself has to change to allow itself to consider both its global strategy and the variety of strategies it needs within the UK in relation to the UK's diversity, not least its multinational diversity. At the moment, it seems that the BBC is not only fighting political pressures and adaptations to technological change and economic pressures, not least around the licence fee, but is also trying to reposition itself for a global marketplace. So I think there are inherent tensions in any sort of attempt to get the BBC to focus on what is needed for Scotland as well as what is needed for its present fight to stay in the game in the UK as a whole.
Members of the panel have expressed views on different facets of a federal structure, but inextricably tied up in that is the question of accountability, which is at the core of everything. And there is a question about the adequacy of accountability of the BBC to the Scottish Parliament within the present structure. Could a greater accountability for Scotland actually be achieved without introducing what I'll call, for want of a better word, a federal structure or a devolved structure? Or would it be necessary to have that devolution, that level of devolution to Scotland, before proper accountability can be brought in?
I suppose in principle there's no reason why the BBC, devolved or undevolved, couldn't report to the Scottish Parliament now, if a mechanism could be found. There would have to be, under these circumstances, legislative change. But I think your question poses... The question is whether is the key thing changed to the devolution settlement affecting this Parliament or change to the BBC. If the BBC were devolved, the same constitutional issue would arise about its accountability at the moment, whether it were devolved or not, I think, because it still would not require, not only would not, not just the case, they wouldn't require to report to this Parliament, but in fact, the legislation enabling this Parliament doesn't give the Parliament oversight of the BBC. So in that sense, I don't think it would matter if the BBC was devolved or not. So two actions would need to take place. This Parliament would need to acquire extra powers, and the BBC would require to be devolved. But I still, what Professor Schlesinger said, I think I agree with. I hear words like, terms like devolution of the BBC, federalisation of the BBC, but since we don't really have a precedent within the BBC, it's actually very difficult to know what that would look like.
I think accountability is a very complex question. I support the BBC being accountable to the licence fee payer. I support the BBC being accountable to this Parliament and to the Westminster Parliament. However, that has to be done without compromising the independence of the BBC, because politicians, forgive me, do need to be kept at arm's length from the BBC for a whole variety of reasons. But what I would particularly like to see is for BBC Scotland to have its own budget. There's a debate at the moment about Ofcom's definitions, Scottish productions, the BBC's and so on and so forth. I haven't seen, because I don't think anybody has seen, BBC Scotland's proper overall budget. And I would like to see that in order to get a handle on how that budget is deployed. And that might, for example, include how much the BBC contributes to the overall how much BBC Scotland contributes to the overall spending of the BBC network. I mean, at the moment, you can see a bit more about STV's budgets than you can about the BBC's budgets, and I think that's unacceptable.
If I may add a word, I think the question of accountability is accountability for what purpose, effectively. And there's absolutely no reason why the BBC should not, I think as it informally does now anyway, submit its report on Scotland to this Parliament and account for what it does. There have been arguments in the public domain about other forms of accountability in terms of its board structure, and I guess that's a complex matter, but one that if it were to be fully proposed might be properly debated. I think we do need to distinguish between financial accountability on the one hand, which would in any case be overseen by bodies such as the National Audit Office, and accountability for the range of programming that the BBC offers. And I think quite a lot gets wrapped up in the discussion about accountability. And I think if that's going to be a serious argument, it's not simply about formal structures, but it's also about distinguishing the different elements of accountability that the Parliament would wish to have?
The members of the panel have had slightly different facets as to what accountability is and the description of that, and obviously that's a different debate. But obviously the Scottish Parliament should have some form of scrutiny over the BBC. And I would ask the panel, what information would be required for that, in your view? I mean, obviously there's going to be slightly different views on that, but what would you view as the essential needs of the Scottish Parliament in scrutinising the BBC in Scotland?
I would have thought, I mean, I don't repeat the point made by Professor Beveridge, that budget is a key one. A lot of the other information is available, actually. And I think then it depends on... It really depends on what, as has been said already, what forms of accountability we're looking at. Other than budgetary information, I should have thought that a lot of the information that the Parliament would need is there. I think the key question is, with what authority is the Parliament scrutinising this information? Which is why many people, actually, since the Parliament was set up, also looked at what seemed to be an anomaly where Scottish culture, there are cultural responsibilities, and the minister with responsibility for Scottish culture, but strictly speaking, that doesn't include broadcasting in terms of the manner in which the Parliament was set up. So I think, danger of repeating myself, I would have thought that the key thing here is, with what degree of authority, under what form of legislation, does the Parliament scrutinise these forms of information? I don't think the information is actually the problem, assuming one can extract detailed information about the budget. What I would say, there is a complication that a lot of people point out that the BBC collects, perhaps we don't know, maybe £350 million thereabouts from the licence fee in Scotland, licence fee plus Scotland's share of commercial activity. And we say that we don't think the BBC spends that on, for example, BBC Scotland or its funding of BBC Alba. On the other hand, the counter-argument is that Scottish listeners and viewers enjoy the full range of BBC services that people do in London and Leeds. And therefore, I think there's a complex bit of arithmetic to be worked out there. This is difficult because people take different positions here. On what exactly is the shortfall, or what is a reasonable estimate of the shortfall in terms of what is spent in Scotland as distinct from the licence fee taken in Scotland. Now, that is a very difficult calculation.
I would go back to 1951 and the report by the late Lord Beveridge and the response by the Westminster government at that time, which says the government attached great importance to the maximum devolution to all areas in programme policy and otherwise, and they agree with the Broadcasting Committee that the existing arrangements are inadequate. That's back in 1951. My experience of the BBC, both as a citizen and as a consumer of their output and so on and so forth, is that they know, just as you know, that they have a problem in Scotland. And they've known for a long time that they have this problem in Scotland from their own research. And they've done not enough about it. We've heard from the BBC, and like Neil, I'm a loyalist, I'm a great supporter of the BBC, but we've heard from BBC Directors General and Chairman, going back decades, there's a problem, we're doing something about it. They're still saying that in their response to your questions for Lord Hall next week. So my proposal, and what I want you to concentrate on, is the future, and not just listening to their rhetoric and saying we're going to do something about it. Find ways of ensuring that they do something about the problems. If this was Marks and Spencer or John Lewis, you would believe that they would have actually solved the problem of cultural representation for Scotland and production in Scotland long ago. My proposal in my submission is that the Director Scotland and the Director General Scotland should have their pay linked to performance. And if they don't really address the purpose gaps in Scotland, then their pay needs to be docked, because they're the people with whom the buck stops. But I don't want you as politicians telling the BBC what should be on the screen and what should not be on the screen. That's why the complex nature of the relationships between regulation and governance and the politicians needs to be handled with great care.
I'd like to strongly support that. I think it's really important that there's no straying into questions that are strictly regulatory. I think one area where the Parliament might take an interest, though, quite properly, is to look at the public purposes of the BBC as these get redefined in the course of the Charter review, and to see to what extent the BBC in Scotland is addressing those public purposes in a satisfactory way. I do think at the same time, again, I would completely agree with what Robert has said, that it's very important to stay out of questions of programming. There is an inevitable tendency in political life to get annoyed about things that are thought to be misrepresentations. I think everyone understands that's the case, but it's really important not to get into that, or indeed to feel as though there should be prescriptiveness about content. But beyond those questions, looking at the underlying principles and arguing about those seems to be a good way in to addressing the BBC's performance.
Okay. Gordon?
Just a very quick question to expand on the subject of accountability. You know, we've spoken about Scottish Parliament's relationship with BBC Scotland and BBC, but I was thinking about the Ofcom Advisory Committee for Scotland and the Audience Council for Scotland as well. In the evidence from the Ofcom Advisory Committee for Scotland, they said that they're concerned that there is a lack of local accountability within Scotland for Scottish-originated output. The current situation means that formally the Audience Council for Scotland needs to provide feedback to the BBC Trust, who then provide feedback to the BBC management in London, who then feedback to the BBC Scotland management team, i.e. there is no direct accountability to BBC Scotland from Audience Council for Scotland. So, you know, how do we address that wider subject where there are other organisations other than the Scottish Parliament who have an interest in what's happening at BBC Scotland?
I agree with what's just been said. I believe that there is accountability from BBC Scotland management to the Audience Council Scotland. The Audience Council Scotland and the chairmanship of the BBC Trustee for Scotland meet almost on a monthly basis. Yeah. The senior management of BBC Scotland are so, there in, and there is dialogue. So in my view...
So Ofcom's wrong in what they've said, the advisory committee?
It depends how you define accountability. A dialogue takes place. So in that sense, there is accountability. The problem is what I referred to in my earlier response. What happens is that dialogue takes place, but not enough changes. So the matter is how you ensure that BBC Scotland management, but in particular, the BBC in London, not only listens, but acts upon what they hear. That's the key point for me.
I think this is you know, an issue that in many ways is a bit up for grabs right now, because the future of the BBC's governance under the trust within which the Audience Council sits is clearly a very moot point. So I would have thought alongside any sort of discussion of accountability to this Parliament, rethinking systems of accountability within the BBC and to its advisory organisations might well be something that should be pursued.
But I presume you agree with that statement that Gordon just read out?
Do I agree with it? Not necessarily.
despite the fact that you sit on the body that wrote it?
Yes, but well, you're getting me into an area that I might just not wish to discuss, really.
Yes, but the body, you sit on the body that wrote that statement that Gordon's just read out. If you don't agree with that, what would you suggest?
I think that there really needs to be... I think the Audience Council, at least from observation, the occasional times that I've met them and seen them in action, finds it quite difficult to be a robust internal critic. And I think this particular year, actually, it does seem to have been one. But I think that's more occasional than, if you like, systemic. And I don't wish to be particularly critical about that. You know, I just think that everyone knows that when the trust was set up. There were lots of questions about it then. There have been issues around its performance ever since. And I'm saying this purely this is my personal view. It's nothing to do with anything else I do. It's as, if you like, as an academic observer. And there are questions being raised about its future. It's a very good moment, really, to be thinking, not just in respect of Scotland, but in terms of thinking about other parts of the UK, how those relationships with the nations and the ways in which the nations are represented and handled might be rethought. I wouldn't go any further than that. I wouldn't want to be prescriptive about it, but I think it's a question that is inevitably going to be looked at because those arrangements are going to be rethought anyway.
Neil?
Can I say that? I mean, I don't think there's any shortage of intelligent, well-informed, robust critique of BBC performance. The absolutely key question is how senior executives respond. We can talk about the mechanisms all day. There is lots of information, for example, about the London-centric nature of the corporation is perceived outside, but that doesn't stop the launch of another series about transport in London or sewage in London or anything else in London. Series called Our Streets, which are all about streets in London, whereas, as have been observed, there are streets in Sheffield and so on. These points have been made endlessly, actually, over a long time. I don't think the perfectibility of critical and reporting mechanisms is the key issue here. It's the response, the attitudes, the culture of senior executives. And that's why, if I may, just as response to two or three things have been said, just return to something I said at the beginning, which is that what the Broadcasting Commission in 2008 had in mind was that rather than hang all these things in the BBC, which is under attack from, it's a minority of people, but very vociferous, very vociferous newspapers and quite vociferous people in Westminster, rather than hang all these responsibilities in the BBC, another way to do this would be to get the BBC to fund a Scottish Channel or part fund the Scottish Channel, and there are models for this, and BBC Alpa is in a sense one of them, not run by the BBC, or not run by the BBC as we understand it now. In other words, I'm taking a slightly more radical position here, possibly, than my colleagues, but what I'm saying is that one way of looking at this is saying we could work away with the BBC at mechanisms which would somehow end up with the BBC running the Scottish Channel completely, with complete commissioning and editing autonomy in Scotland. But the signs from the BBC are not really that they would be very good at doing that. And therefore, another model, if we're worried about what they spend in Scotland in relation to what they take from the licence fee, is to look for funding rather than a large shift in culture and the ability to run a Scottish Channel. And I'm simply suggesting that these two models are out there.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like
Robert.
To add a few points, if I may, about BBC governance and Scotland. I was part of a campaign over a decade ago when Ofcom was set up out of the existing legacy regulators, Independent Television Commission, Radio Authority and so on and so forth, to try to ensure that on the main board of Ofcom there was representation for Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, as well as a member for England. That battle was lost. Ofcom decided that they would have people who were described as partners. Not governors, not commissioners, not trustees, but partners. And the representation for Scotland within the current structure of Ofcom is there's a Scottish member on the content board. In other words, Scotland and the listener and viewer in Scotland does not have a seat on the main board of Ofcom as the main broadcasting and telecoms regulator in the UK. We've had in the BBC, in relation to BBC governance since the early 1950s, a member for Scotland who was the governor and then became the trustee. We are now engaged in a process which is going to lead to a new settlement, a new BBC charter. The dominant position seems to be the BBC Trust will be abolished and will be replaced by a unitary board. Now, if we go back to the last BBC charter, around 2005-2006, I took part in the Burns hearings down in London. Michael Grade at that stage was a leader in setting up the BBC Trust, and he was at this meeting talking about his wish to have governors or trustees who had the right skill set to run the BBC as a large organisation, which I fully support. I agree, that's what he wanted. But I said, well, what are we going to do about Scotland? Because where is the representation for Scotland going to be in that new system? Unfortunately, that continued. But I think in some ways it might have been a close-run thing. And I'm very concerned about future voice of Scotland, future representation for Scotland in any new BBC governance structure. Rona Fairhead has been talking about having a unitary board with non-executive directors. Well, the existing non-executive directors on the BBC board failed. They failed when it came to executive payoffs. They failed when it came to looking over the digital initiative. And the BBC Trust, which has done some very good things as well as some things not so good, took the blame for what was the problem with the non-executive directors. Now, if we have a unitary board with non-executive directors, are we going to have a non-executive director for Scotland? Maybe. Is that the right term we want to have for a public organisation? I think that could be part of a long-term plan to start privatising the BBC 15 years down the road and turn it into a company instead of a public corporation. So I would counsel the Scottish Parliament and this committee in particular to think through those issues in whatever you put into the charter review process.
Thank you. Gordon, did you have anything else?
Okay.
Mary Scanlon.
Yes, can I just, convener, pick up something in Professor Beveridge's 14-page submission, which I have to say I found quite offensive. Regarding River City, not your taste, but yes, your late mother enjoyed it, and I'm confident there are many mums and others south of the border who might wish to view it.
I apologise.
I actually find that quite sexist and ageist as well.
I understand.
Well, I'm giving you the opportunity to apologise because I actually think it's a very good programme, and I don't think we need that when we're sitting looking at BBC Scotland getting more production.
You're entirely right, and I'm afraid I was carried away.
You should never have written it then.
That's correct, and I was referring to my mother at the time.
Yes, but mum's south of the border. Do you think men don't watch River City?
Men do watch River City, and I agree entirely with you that it should have been changed.
Well, I did find it quite offensive.
Thank you for...
in your position, you won't do it again.
Let's move on.
Thank you for bringing it to my attention, and I give you an unreserved apology.
That's fine. That'll do for me. Can I just ask, are any of you familiar with the Memorandum of Understanding, which was actually changed by this Parliament's Audit Committee, and it requires that the annual accounts and report is laid in front of this Parliament and scrutinised by the Parliament's Audit Committee, which Colin Beattie and I both sit on. Are you familiar with the Memorandum of Understanding, and are you familiar with the work of this Parliament's Audit Committee?
I'm aware of the Memorandum of Understanding. I'm not familiar with what the Audit Committee does, but I think the Memorandum of Understanding in some respects mirrors the relationship between Ofcom and this Parliament, if I'm not mistaken, or at least that there was something very similar drawn up quite a few years ago now about the reporting to this Parliament by Ofcom.
It's the BBC Scotland's annual accounts and report.
Yes, I understand.
And this Parliament's Audit Committee is very effective in their scrutiny of such documents. But if you're not familiar with it, I find that a bit disappointing because it's a huge part of the accountability.
I think I would draw your attention to the response which you've just had from the BBC itself, which says, consideration is currently being given to us to how statistical information pertaining to each of the nations, including Scotland, may best be incorporated. And I think not only I, but other people sometimes have some difficulty, notwithstanding the expertise of the committee to which you refer, in unravelling the complexity of the BBC's accounts. And I would hope for improvement in the future, in particular to enable us to disentangle spending in Scotland by the BBC and the BBC Scotland's account from the UK version.
Well, that's a job for the Audit Committee.
And yes, it is.
I have to say that it's a very competent Audit Committee.
I don't doubt it for one moment.
Right, can I just go on to the distribution on spend in regions of the United Kingdom by channel. We've got Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland have all increased in the last 4 years between 1.5% and 2%. Can I just ask a direct question? What proportion of the licence fee collected in Scotland, in your opinion, should be spent in Scotland?
More, certainly. I'm going to be honest, I find that the kind of question which I think can only be answered in dialogue with the BBC over very specific three-year or four-year plans, because I'm very sympathetic to the view that the BBC could spend more of the licence fee in Scotland. And just to put this in perspective, if we look at what a channel might cost, it might cost maybe 80 million or something of that sort a year to run. And that's not necessarily a lot of money. The Director General of the BBC recently found, and I'm glad he did, £85 million for the World Service, for example, new money, as it were, but money obviously coming from existing budgets. And it's very important that he should. So we can talk this around with a number of figures. The difficult part of the argument is to quantify the cost, the legitimate cost, as it were, here, of the amenities which Scottish viewers and listeners have in common with the rest of the United Kingdom. Because I think, and I do feel sympathetic with BBC managers about this, when people say you only spend so much in Scotland but you collect 350 million, sometimes that argument doesn't take account of the fact that people here watch Strictly, they watch the Great British Bake Off and Great British Menu, as I know I do myself. And therefore, to quantify what is legitimate in hard figures, I think, is very difficult. I think what I think one can go this far. I think one can say there's still quite a big gap, given the size of the gap between what is collected and what appears to be spent, to the extent that we can agree what is spent. Because I know that one of the other submissions from Tern, one of the independent companies, notices the lift and shift question about what exactly counts as expenditure.
Much like,
so I'm,
as well.
I'm dodging your question in the arithmetical sense, but I would think that there is room for substantially more expenditure. You mentioned, by the way, the 1.5% more and so on. In my 25 years or so of being connected one way or another with the BBC, including doing in the past audience research for it and so on, I've seen these figures go up and down. Yeah. And I'm a little bit sceptical.
Just over the last 4 years.
Yeah, it's gone up to 9 and then down to 3, for example. Yeah. And if you look at the BBC as a whole, I think what's more interesting is the pattern of regional expenditure over years than what is happening over the next year or what happened last year. And this doesn't just apply to Scotland. I mean, we all used to be conscious of where BBC Birmingham was, a pebble mill at one, and then pebble mill stopped being important. So there's lots of evidence of the BBC prioritising a regional spend and then withdrawing it and putting it somewhere else. The point, I've made it before, I think I've made it here probably before, but is that's not very strategic. We tend to get quick fixes where the BBC react to saying, well, you only spent 3% or something this year in Scotland. Okay, we'll go up to 9% next year. Yeah. But it doesn't seem to me to constitute a strategic broadcasting strategy in Scotland.
The BBC did increase its expenditure. And what did it do? It brought in the weakest link, Waterloo Road, and Question Time to be run out of Glasgow. And that's good, because that increases jobs and investment in the creative industries in Scotland. But what it did not do was meet the needs of the licence fee payer in Scotland by improving cultural representation. Yeah. And also, the weakest link was near the end of its life. As I think I said at one meeting around that time, and one can quite well understand why the BBC in its out-of-London strategy didn't place the weakest link in Wales, because Anne Robinson wouldn't have gone down well in Wales. And then it closed. Waterloo Road then closed. So what we need is a strategy for investment in the creative industries in Scotland, led by the BBC, but not only the BBC, and to improve cultural representation in the interests of the licence fee payer and the citizen in Scotland?
I think I'm actually with you, Mr. Blain, because I think the targets and quotas, and we've discussed them in this committee often enough in the past, that it's a crude measurement and it can vary by the year. But what I really want to ask is, and you, in response to Colin Beattie, you mentioned federalism in some detail. I'm not asking you to repeat that again. But, you know, given that we have this system of lift and shift, which was explained very well by Matchlight Productions, you know, and it's looking at the extent of quotas. You know, how effective are quotas in, you know, ensuring content production? Or is it just an artificial market which can chop and change at any time, as you saw with The Weakest Link? So what I'm really looking for is, what options would you like to suggest for more sustainable production in Scotland, and you know, how this could be monitored and enforced in future? We've talked about federalism, we've talked about quotas. You know, should there simply be... is federalism the answer? Is it Devo Max or whatever? But instead of looking at what we shouldn't have, could you tell us what we should have?
I think I think we know quite a lot about the history of quotas, not just from television, but from the film industry. We could go back to the 1930s when there were people in the British film industry who thought that there could be a mini Hollywood, you know, in Pinewood and Ealing and elsewhere. Quotas tend to come and go. Now, I, at the risk of sounding like a sort of a channel bore, as it were, no wordplay intended, I think one of the things which you find if you look in Ireland and you look at the media situation there, it's rather stable across the board. If I take us back to when the opt-out model started in Scotland, STV appeared in 1957. And from that time onwards, we accepted that in Scotland we would have an opt-out model where Scottish viewers... Radio was different, by the way. We should probably always talk more about radio than we do, actually. We're talking about TV. But as far as TV go, we have accepted since that time that Scottish viewers watch what everyone else in the United Kingdom does. And with the exception of BBC Alba, we still do somewhat what we did in the 1950s and 60s to a varying extent. We come out of the schedule and we watch things which only Scottish viewers watch at certain times. And that puts a clear lid on what STV and BBC Scotland can do. And it's not of their making, and I'm not critical of them. They work within that restricted environment. But I suppose what I'm saying is, we have an opt-out model which was valid in the days of Larry Marshall and the 1 o'clock gang, who I mentioned with all respect. At that time, we also had a vigorous press, an indigenous press, a well-resourced press. Television wasn't particularly important. It now is. One of the things we know about TV is it's very important democratically and economically. We couldn't have foreseen in 1957 how important economically TV could become. I think my answer to you is the BBC, I am reliably told, and indeed I even reported this on a BBC programme at the time, it was an article in The Guardian in just towards the end of August, that there had in fact been a plan for the BBC to launch a Scottish channel before a further round of cuts. Now, I don't know the detail of that. And if the BBC envisaged a Scottish channel actually based in Scotland with, as I've said before, editing and commissioning autonomy here, hallelujah. If it was going to run something like that, I think that would be good. I think that is the answer. I've heard senior managers at BBC Scotland and STV say that channels are not the answer. And yet STV, in fact, has launched a couple, STV Glasgow and Edinburgh. So I suppose they must believe in channels at some point. So I think my answer to you is, I find it difficult to see the kind of production base we want to see being built up here, unless we have at least one channel which is commissioning a lot more work than is commissioned in Scotland just now.
So my question was really about an income and expenditure model. But instead of an income and expenditure model, quotas, federalism or whatever, what you're saying is the answer is a BBC Scotland-only channel. That's the answer. I'm looking for a funding model.
It is theoretically imaginable in a way which I think... federalism to me isn't, because I simply don't know what BBC federalism would look like. I know what channels look like. I know that I know how RTE works in Ireland and TV3 works in Ireland and how Catalan channels do, and there's one in every Dutch province, and all the German lender have them under German constitutional law. And the fact that we have BBC Alpa, I think, is wonderful, but I think BBC Alpa can itself be something of a model for an English language channel. But I'm afraid I'm very old-fashioned. I believe in channels. So that.
Have you got a quick question?
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions on income and expenditure.
Okay.
Earlier on, Professor Blain, you said that RTE was struggling financially but had six channels and four radio stations. Now, I had a quick look at their accounts there. Their operating costs are €312 million, yes, euros, which equates to £234 million. Mm-hmm. BBC in Scotland, according to the answers the BBC gave us, the licence fee alone raises £323 million, yes, in Scotland. Do you think that, bearing in mind the service provision provided in Ireland, that Scotland actually gets good value for money out of that £323 million?
No, forgive me. I don't want to overdo RTE struggles. All I was trying to say was I don't want to paint a rosy picture of the Irish broadcasting environment, because TV3, which is RTE's main competitor, commercial competitor, has had to take out a lot of loans and so on. Mm. There have been moments where RTE have struggled. But, no, in answer to your question, I mean, I greatly envy not just the Irish broadcasting environment, but the Irish media environment. They also have a newspaper, the Irish Times, which has been the envy of several Scottish newspaper editors. Mm-hmm. And this is the Republic has a smaller population than Scotland. So if we're looking at what's imaginable, I think Ireland is a good model. Of course, its history is entirely different, and there are all sorts of differences which have brought about the existence of RTE. But I don't want to overdo RTE's struggles. I merely make the point that when I say there are six channels, a couple of them don't do very much. One was just set up last Saturday. Mm. But nonetheless, if we say that BBC Alpa is the equivalent of the Irish language channel, that still leaves us with five other TV channels in Ireland, and we have none strictly comparable, in the sense that STV works on an opt-out, as does BBC Scotland. So I have no difficulty using the Irish model as something which we should look at least in an interested way. Yeah. Philip?
Yes, I would be loath to throw out quotas before any other solution has been found, because quotas are at least a commitment to a distributed conception of spend around the UK. And there may be shortfalls in how this works, and there may be questions asked about whether all the accounting is accurate. But it's a very important principle that not everything should be centred in London and the South East.
Yeah.
And I think on any sort of conception of an autonomous Scottish broadcaster, there too, that broadcaster would not be self-sustaining. It would be part of a wider system. It would be part of a trading system. And that means it has to do business with the rest of the network, and it has to do business with the world. And so whatever's spent is, if you like, an investment in trying to do better by producing competitive programming and finding markets. So that's only partly a solution. I don't think that necessarily solves the problem of how the funding for broadcasting gets distributed around the UK system. It might be part of the answer. I don't think it's an answer in itself necessarily, because a lot will depend on its performance in the end.
Sorry, Parliament accepted unanimously the report of the Scottish Broadcasting Commission under Blair Jenkins. At a stroke, the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament could set up a Scottish digital network, invest the money and improve the creative economy and improve cultural representation from Scotland, in addition to how the BBC improves its performance in the future. One of the questions for me for the SNP Government is, why have they not proceeded with setting up a Scottish digital network?
Would that mean that we would be paying for it twice, once for the BBC and once for a new Scottish channel?
Well, the Digital Network Panel, which followed the Broadcasting Commission up and which reported in 2011, actually suggested that this channel be set up with a now, it's a dead issue now, it's a sale of spectrum, that's gone, but suggested, in fact, the BBC take that over from 2017. I suppose what I'm suggesting is you could have a mixed funding model. The network panel didn't want to recommend advertising or sponsorship, partly because that would hit the existing broadcaster, STV, and hit other people too. Mm. Although I have to point out, again, the RTE, the national broadcaster in Ireland, has a mix of licence and advertising. And, you know, I think one has to say, looking at the SBC's recommendations, that, I mean, I would have thought no avenue of funding should be shut off for discussion if that's the only way we could achieve a national channel.
One other quick question. Given that we haven't got a method yet of providing a Scottish service, whether it's through a federal BBC or whether it's through a dedicated channel, in evidence to a Westminster committee in September, it was highlighted that in Wales, BBC spend per head is £122, Northern Ireland is £103, Scotland is £88, and London is £757 per head. How can we leverage more money out of the BBC, bearing in mind that there's another round of cuts coming?
I suspect when you talk to them, they may wish to verify the figures, first of all.
Well, they didn't criticise them when it was raised by an MP at the Parliament in September, UK Parliament in September.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are, as it were, short-term, mid-range solutions and longer-term, more radical solutions to Scottish broadcasting. And, you know, one can't see into the future. You would say, you know, if there are too many obstacles against the setting up of an actual channel, although, like Robert, I have to say, I'm not entirely sure what they are, since they don't seem to be obstacles in similarly sized nations or sub-nations anywhere else. But if there are these obstacles, then the very least we would want to see is parity of BBC spend. I agree with you, but I then think it would mean spend on what? If it were spend on bringing programmes, network programmes, you know, towards the end of their life to Glasgow for a little while and then going away again, then it wouldn't be a great benefit. What we don't seem to have, and I do think there may be a constitutional aspect to this in terms of parliamentary oversight here, despite, and I take the point about the very good work of the Audit Committee, but I think it's very difficult to get a media, and particularly a media production strategy going in Scotland, which makes it easier to set up independent production companies and get work for them. And I think if you looked, I can't cite you the figures, but if you looked at, you can look at Dublin as well as London, where you look, it's not just work for production companies, it's a whole lot of collateral benefit in the creative sector. But the trouble with quotas and adjustments in spend is that they might work for a year or 2 years, give people some work, but it's not a strategic build of an infrastructure. Mm. And in that sense, you want to be able to spend money on media infrastructure the way you do in the Fourth Crossing or improving the M8. It ought to be part of our economic infrastructure.
I think you've got two choices. One is to go for, in effect, a Barnett formula for the BBC, where you say how much is going to be spent per head in Scotland. Or the other way is to take the licence fee, which is raised in Scotland, give it to BBC Scotland, give it BBC Scotland much more autonomy, and allow them to spend the money as they think fit, opting in or out of programmes from London as they see fit. And that's certainly the model that I would wish to pursue.
Dick and then Liam.
And I welcome the comments that Professor Beveridge has made in terms of performance. The BBC has lost its way, clearly, as happens with a monolith. And we look at the revenue generation side is abysmal. In fact, they focus almost entirely on reducing costs. And given the disproportionate situation, we talked about revenue and expenditure in Scotland,
it's inevitable, and it has happened, that there might be a disproportionate impact on the costs in Scotland, which are primarily people who work for BBC Scotland. Wouldn't it be easier within a federal type, you might have the unitary board, by setting up BBC Scotland as a separate company within, you know, as I say, a subsidiary of BBC overall, responsible for its performance, responsible for its revenue generation, and that might be working with other BBC subsidiaries, and so that performance can be measured, because clearly it's not today. You've made the point, Professor Beveridge, that performance should be, pay should be related to performance, and it's not. Wouldn't it be simpler just to say it is going to be a separate legal entity with responsibility for its revenue and expenditure?
Very well with the current Director General, Lord Hall's, wish for a leaner, fitter organisation in which decisions are made more quickly. And that might help the BBC and BBC Scotland to improve its performance in a rapidly changing technological and cultural environment. So, yes, I agree with you. That's the way we need to go.
Thank you.
It might, though, from a BBC point of view, and I mean, their response to that would be very interesting. It might be seen as the thin end of a dangerous wedge too, because, and I'm very sympathetic to this, there's this critical mass question about the BBC that once you start chopping bits of it off, that might not stop in Scotland. It might be a model which some of the BBC's detractors south of the border might want to use. And I think there is a genuine difficulty for the BBC that, I mean, I've always, for example, opposed the subscription model for the BBC because I think it's extremely dangerous. The BBC shrinks, and I mean, you said a monolith, and it is large, and I think many people think it could be cut back, and it has been cut back to an extent. But that would probably be seen as the BBC is a danger. The other thing I might say to you is if that were a separate operating company, the question would arise, why the BBC? Would it still be the BBC? And if it wouldn't still be the BBC, why not a Scottish broadcasting company of the sort of the Broadcasting Commission envisaged? I mean, you
might have a general agreement at the unitary board level, yeah, policy, yes, but the operation, I mean, today, yes, it's all mixed up, policy, yes, and operation, and it is London-centric.
Yes.
So if you had that type of operation, wouldn't it be easier to measure the performance operationally? Doesn't mean that the policy couldn't be an overarching policy across the subsidiary or parts of the federal structure.
Yeah, I mean, I can see an attraction in that if there is not another solution for greater broadcasting autonomy. But I'm just anticipating that the BBC would be very nervous about it in case it created a model through which other bits of the BBC got broken off as well.
And but I think we're very nervous about the BBC now.
Yeah. Yes.
One of the problems with what you suggest, however, is the often voiced complaint that BBC Scotland is parochial. And I have to say that I watched the Peter Watkins documentary Culloden recently, which is a landmark in television. It wasn't made by BBC Scotland. It was made by BBC London. So one would hope and wish or try to find policies which enabled BBC Scotland, if it had devolution max, to have much more confidence in its programme making and its commissioning. That if you just go down the parochial road, nobody's going to want that. What we want is vision and ambition.
Okay. Thank you. Liam.
Thanks, Convener. I should start with declaring an interest, as I have a brother who works for the BBC. I just want to pick up a couple of points. Professor Blain, you referred a couple of occasions to the situation in Ireland, and I think you were fairly honest about the pros and cons there. As I understand it, you have that advertising component, which presumably would be seen as a potential threat in were there any kind of lift and shift of that model into the Scottish circumstance. But I understand another criticism of the way in which it's structured in Ireland is that there's an awful lot of money spent on imports, and actually the kind of ecology then of production that's indigenous to Ireland is perhaps not as extensive as one might imagine for the range of channels that exist there. Would that be fair?
It's been a constant criticism, not just over RTE's performance, but over TV3, the main commercial broadcaster, too. And the response has been to commit to greater quantities, and we are, I'm afraid, back to quotas here. But the response has been to commit to greater quantities of Irish production, a proportion of Irish production on an annual basis. I mean, that doesn't worry me enormously, actually, because we are, after all, talking about quite considerable channel spread in Ireland. RTE2, for example, is aimed at a rather different market from RTE1. There is at least one channel which is aimed largely at a youth market. Now, if you do that, you're going to import more, and across the whole of the channels, the total of your production is going to be smaller. But we're envisaging a situation in Scotland where, in channel terms, we start from extremely modest beginnings. Therefore, I'm aware, and I'm sure you will hear from people in the industry about this, of all sorts of good ideas for television series and programmes which don't get made. I mean, I simply absolutely do not buy the idea that we don't have the television talent here. It's absurd. We've got it in literature and music and theatre, visual arts and everything else. Responding to something Robert said a little while ago, actually, if you look, some of the best arts programming you will see on the BBC network will have BBC Scotland as one of the co-producers. There's a great deal of... And in fact, one of the attractions in having the ability to commission more work here is that you retain more talent and you bring talent back. So, I mean, I take your point. There's no point in setting up new channels if you're not commissioning new work. But I think we have the talent to do that. I think the problem at the moment is we don't, as it were, have the patronage.
On that specific point, I mean, you referred earlier on to the rise and fall of Pebble Mill, and I think it illustrates the kind of the trends that any broadcaster is going to have to cope with and try to remain ahead of as best they can. I mean, are there areas of strength where in Scotland, almost irrespective of the model, we need to be playing to far more seriously than we are?
We've always been very good in Scotland at factual and arts, but actually, I mean, drama also. I should say, and maybe it's more for those people who represent the independent industry, to the production industry, to make this point. One of the difficulties in retaining the BBC as the sole provider of future development in Scottish broadcasting is that you still have one commissioner. And one of the difficulties for the indie sector in Scotland is, particularly if Channel 4 is not commissioning much, that it's the BBC which they're always dealing with. This has worked all right for one or two people, but I mean, it's worth maybe a marker for, because I know you're talking to other people, but what's at issue here is if it's always only the BBC, then that's where the patronage is. And I think the advantage of spreading the... Of some sort of even minimal channel spread is you get more people commissioning, different people commissioning, and people can pitch to a wider range of broadcasters. So if we ever got to the point where we had five English language channels in Scotland and we were worried about the quantity we were commissioning, that would be a luxury for us just now. We're not anywhere near that.
Why is the British television industry so much more successful than the British film industry? The British film industry has peaks and troughs over a number of decades. The answer to me is because the British state mandates the licence fee, and that then gets invested into the British television industry, and it allows over a period of time success. So when I look at the relationship between Scotland and London, what I see is Scotland being the British film industry and London being Hollywood. That's the kind of paradigm that I have. So what we need to do is invest fully the licence fee raised in Scotland, not just making programmes for Scotland, but for the international market and the UK market, and then we'll get the success that the British television industry has had over the years through the licence fee.
That probably brings on to a point I was going to raise. I mean, in the absence of a representative from the Royal Society, it may be only fair to... point out one of the issues that they were raising. I mean, they talked about the asymmetry that there is across the UK, and I think you've all acknowledged that, but then go on to say any new approach must be designed to strengthen the arrangements in different parts of the BBC, but it must not be at the expense of reducing its scale or scope or its social relevance across the UK. Yes. It's important that the BBC's position as a global broadcaster should be underpinned by the new organisational arrangements. Absolutely. And not weakened. So I mean, how do we square that circle? Because I think we're discussing this morning the very compelling demand for arrangements that speak more accurately to the demand that is in Scotland. But at the same time, there's a recognition from BBC loyalists such as yourselves that what we have here is of value and that one must proceed to some extent with a degree of caution that we don't end up throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Mm.
I do think that's right, actually, and I think it's also important while we're having a discussion about the BBC that we should also think about the general questions facing public service broadcasting out with the BBC. There are threats to the future of Channel 4, which would have major implications for independent production, for example. There's a continuous question mark over whether or not ITV is going to get bought over. What characterises a great deal of the British TV industry is actually that it's subordinate to US company interests, in effect, you know, operating here but nonetheless owned from outside. So you've got some quite interesting trends going on, which I think do have a direct bearing on whether or not the scope and scale of the BBC is not even more likely to be an asset to the UK as a whole, you know, irrespective of how questions relating to Scotland get sorted out. I think also that one of the things in relation to the discussion of channels and in relation to the discussion of programme making that we really haven't talked about is the changing nature of consumption, which everyone will know is a gravitation towards quite a lot of short form viewing, which is, you know, related to television in some respects and others not. New entrants into the market, particularly for long form drama, which are quite a challenge to production of drama around the UK as a whole. Demographic changes, particularly amongst young people, but not exclusively by any means, in terms of how they consume audiovisual content via mobiles, particularly. One of the revolutionary changes for older people has actually been the use of the tablet, two-screen watching. So there are many, many things going on which are affecting the future performance of the industry as a whole. And any sort of debate about this and any debate about channels really needs to take account of that quite confusing complexity which is still being worked out, I think.
Can I just check with something? You mentioned earlier the issue about quotas. There seems to be support for quotas, at least in the short term.
In my case?
In general, I'm asking.
I wouldn't like to speak for these guys, but I think short of any other solution, a commitment to a quota is one way of recognising that not everything should be centred within the M25.
Under the present arrangements, are you agreeing that quotas are a useful thing?
I think they're useful, yes, I do.
You wouldn't refuse a quota fix where one is on offer and it improves the revenue, but it would still be a quick fix.
Yes. Was that? Yeah. However, at the moment, of course, quota is a quota for not Scotland on its own, but a much wider quota. So my question really is, would you support a change to the quota as part of this process we're going through so that there's a Scotland-specific quota?
Well, there are upsides and downsides attached to that, I think, because the question is, how do you calculate the quota?
Well, how do you calculate the quota just now?
Well, it's in many respects, it's a kind of a balance of forces calculation, isn't it? It's how interests get worked out. But if you were to, let's say you made an argument for Scotland that it was proportionate to population or something like that. If Scotland's demographic weakened relative to the rest of the UK, you know, that would be a declining quota, so that would not be a good basis for a quota. So we'd have to kind of find arguments for a quota which are not totally tied to population, for example, I think.
When the Pacific Quay was opened, Michael Lyons and Mark Thompson at that stage referred to 9% being a floor, not a ceiling. So that sounded very good. And then we got the weakest link. Then we got Waterloo Road. Then we got Question Time, which is run out of Glasgow, but actually is UK-wide. So I think you need to drill down into the granularity of quotas. But I'm in favour of quotas if, as Neil says, there's nothing better. But Scotland deserves better.
Can I just add, I mean, there's more than one way of looking at parity, because, for example, BBC Alpa is keen to get BBC making more programming for that station to put them on a par with the Welsh channel. Right. So this is a multifaceted argument.
And I think we're going to come on to some of those facets just with Gordon.
Thanks very much, Convener. Mary's already touched upon part of the lift and shift situation, and I was wanting to ask what your views were on what impact current BBC commissioning practices has had on Scottish-based production companies. What's your view? The reason for asking it is I was looking at television network hours across all of the BBC channels, and BBC outputs 31,000 hours, of which Scotland's local output is 882. I accept it excludes network. But music and arts, they had 1,800 hours of music and arts, of which Scotland's population share would have been 156 hours. BBC Scotland actually produced 29. Entertainment, they produced 1,100 hours. Scotland's share would have been 96 hours. We had two. And comedy, again, 1,700 hours for comedy. Scotland's share, 144. We actually had nine. So I'm just wondering what you thought of, you know, how their practices were working, bearing in mind what you said, Professor Beveridge, about Waterloo Road, Weakest Link, Question Time, the lottery shows, Homes Under the Hammer, which are all UK productions, but based in Scotland.
Not only that, but given the fact we are sitting in the capital of Scotland, which has the biggest international arts festival in the world by far, I think BBC Scotland and the BBC's performance has been lamentable in relation to that, although it has improved in recent years. Speaking as a consumer, I don't have the data in front of me, my feeling is that the BBC seems to pay more attention to Glastonbury than it does to the Edinburgh Festival. And I would like much more attention paid to Edinburgh and much more attention paid to the Edinburgh Festival. And it's about getting the BBC to change its mindset and be aware of that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you would expect a kind of pro rata system where you went through every kind of television programming, sport, arts, whatever, and had some precise proportion of that being done in Scotland. I think what you would like to see, though, and I suspect the people who actually produce, do independent production for BBC Scotland and the network will have more to say about this, but I suspect what you would like to see is more choice in Scotland over what sort of programming goes to the network. I mean, one's impression is that it's possible for Scotland to be stereotyped outside in terms of the sorts of programming that people want from Scotland, the sort of programming which might be considered from Scotland, what sort of things might be networkable, for example, and in what sort of areas Scotland is seen as having strengths. And I think that's where these kinds of decisions are not made here. And taking Philip's point about the fact that we do need to look at the obsolescence of the channel idea over time, nonetheless, the strength of the channel is that if you can have these decisions being made inside a channel, then you can develop strengths and you can get a channel which is perhaps very good at doing arts and sports or something of that kind. And I think it's been very difficult for that to happen in Scotland, both for the commercial broadcaster, which is fitting into the network in a kind of in a particular pattern, and for the BBC. So I think, in a sense, the argument always goes back to where the autonomy is in commissioning and editing decisions, as distinct from working with existing quotas. And I agree with you that some of these figures, you know, don't make very happy viewing.
In terms of, we asked the BBC regarding what counts as Scottish content, and what they said was, what qualifies as Scottish is set by Ofcom, not by the BBC. Mm. But is that by statute or by voluntary agreement? I mean, does the BBC have to abide by what Ofcom says, or is a voluntary agreement that they've got? Does anybody know?
It's not by statute.
Right.
No.
Ofcom do regulate the BBC for harm and offence and probably in the future impartiality and accuracy and balance as well. As far as I know,
Ofcom scrutinises the claims made about programmes produced under the the quota. I think it doesn't go any further than that.
No, no,
so I mean to say that Ofcom determines Scottish content, I think, would not be quite accurate, at least in my understanding.
Right.
I think it's purely related to quota questions.
In terms of, you know, what the BBC have said about what qualifies as Scottish, they have referred to the Ofcom's regional production, where two out of the three criteria must be met, but it all refers to outside the M25 and has no reference to Scotland at all in what they've supplied to us. And I'm just wondering whether the three criteria that's laid down, which is in terms of production base, production budget and production talent, whether that should actually be built into the BBC Charter for Scotland. And instead of saying where it says the UK outside the M25 should actually refer to Scotland specifically. So, for instance, the first one would say instead of the production company must have a substance of business and production based in the UK outside of the M25, it should say the production company must have a substance of business and production base in Scotland, and whether that would address the problem that we're seeing where we've got a lift and shift.
Well, in part, I mean, I've suggested there'd be a service licence for BBC Scotland per se. But if you step back a bit and you look at what happened with Wales, Wales got Doctor Who and Torchwood. Mm. Now, these were not Welsh representation, although the locations were Welsh, particularly in the case of Torchwood. But they were good economic policy. This is where economic policy and cultural policy intersect with each other. And certainly, what I would keep on saying is the BBC has known for a long time that the audience in Scotland is unhappy with its product and unhappy with portrayal. And that's where the focus should be. And whether you do that by changing the public purposes, which would be my preferred route, or whether you do it by putting pressure on BBC management, that's the road to go down and that's the problem that needs to be addressed.
So I'm just wondering, we've touched on most of the rest of what I was going to ask, but you know, how do we ensure that there's more local decision making in relation to commission and programme? Is it the specific Scottish channel, or is it as a part of a federal BBC? What would be the ideal way to go?
The BBC could make a decision to relocate commissioning. I mean, it doesn't require any federalisation. It requires a sort of desire to decentralise and to make it happen here. Mm. I think really.
And my idea of relocating
BBC Two or BBC Four to Scotland was criticised in the second leader in Scotland on Sunday as just shifting the office and wouldn't change anything.
But if you not only shift the office, as it were, but you shift the commissioning power, you shift the budget, then you go into a situation where in the independent production sector, for example, in Scotland, doesn't have to pay a fortune to stay in a London hotel or go down by sleeper. And that would benefit the industry in the north of England as well, because they'd just be able to nip up to Edinburgh or Glasgow instead of having to go down to London again. And that would contribute to a mindset shift in the culture of the BBC, which I think would be too welcomed. So you shift the budgets, you shift the commissioning power, suddenly you get change. But there'll be a lot of resistance to this from Westminster and also from the BBC in London.
Okay. I have heard in one or two... Sorry,
briefly.
Yes, yes, I've said one or two firms, and you may hear this when you speak to the BBC. The declared intention to try to do that, actually, to try to move more autonomy towards BBC Scotland in that manner, but one would obviously want to look at the detail of that.
Okay, thank you. Going to move on. Check.
Yeah, briefly, following on that point. 10 months ago, we had produced a report on the economic impact of the film, TV and video games industry in Scotland. And there was a call then to increase support for independent TV production based in Scotland, and that the relevant Scottish Parliament Committee should assess whether the BBC has met its production intent. And coming to the point that Professor Beveridge has just made in terms of commissioning, Ewan Angus at that time, head of commissioning for BBC Scotland, said, and I quote, we now, this is 10 months later, he said this 10 months ago, we now need to ensure that the companies that are based in Scotland are winning entirely new business and are drawing from the local population and talent base. BBC doesn't care about Scotland at all, does it?
My view is I'm afraid you're overstating that. I think they do care about Scotland, but they need to have the tools with which to improve their performance at Pacific Key.
Back to Professor Beveridge's point in relation to the Edinburgh Festival and Glastonbury. I mean, I suspect there's a degree of caricaturing it. I mean, I think looking at the coverage, for example, of Tea in the Park as opposed to Glastonbury would be a more accurate comparison to make. It's not to say that there isn't more that could be done with the Edinburgh Festivals. I think you're absolutely right there. But I think to downplay some of the stuff they've done, clearly catering, as they see it, to the same market, Tea in the Park would be a more
that's
relevant...
That's a fair comment.
But it was on the point of quotas, really, Convener. I think everybody accepts they're a fairly blunt instrument and trying to fashion criteria that are going to be stand the test of time is always going to be fairly fraught. But how do we manage a situation where there are co-productions, where you've got different interests north, south of the border and from across the regions of the UK taking part? Is there a way of assigning the different components to it more accurately, rather than saying if you achieve a certain percentage, then 100% of that will be allocated as a nation spend in Scottish terms, for example?
I think that's a producer question, you know, in terms of working out those how that relates to criteria. I mean, I would have thought it would be possible to allocate different elements to different parts.
Well, I mean, I think the example that Matchlight gave us illustrated the point of lift and shift by, I think, suggesting around about 5% of the actual spend in Scotland could lead to 100% of the allocation of that spend as effectively part of Scottish contribution. Now, by any stretch, that's lunacy. Mm-hmm. But if by trying to subdivide it, does it get so complex in terms of the way that productions are put together that it's just too elusive?
I'd have thought the more criteria you have, the more difficult it's going to be to resolve those questions, definitely. Mm.
But it will never be exact, and it would never satisfy everyone. It's like what is the question about, you know, what constitutes a British film, for example. But I think you'll find co-productions all around Europe. Anyone who's watched some of the programmes we import from Scandinavia, for example, Scandinoir programmes, will see that these are co-productions with multiple partners. And I think what will tend to happen if you're looking at inside the Netherlands, let's say, if people are going to... talk about the proportions of Flemish co-production or something. There are arithmetics for doing that, which will probably be inexact and probably be debated, but you could do it.
Yeah. There are excellent examples of co-productions at the moment. It's called BBC working with MG Alba, and BBC Alba produces very good programmes that also work internationally, so let's put more investment into MG Alba. The Chancellor recently, in a decision which I regarded, frankly, as cheap and shoddy, took the £1 million away from BBC Alba. So I would suggest that this Parliament and this Government restore the £1 million to BBC Alba, please. And I think you'd get a lot of value for that investment.
Can I just go back to the Matchlight example? I mean, I thought Matchlight gave a particularly clear example of how the quotas could work. Not a real example, but I mean, clearly it is feasible using the rules to, as already been said, that a programme could be deemed to be Scottish, that 100% of the budget allocation is deemed to be Scottish, even though 5% of the spend is in Scotland. I mean, is that frankly a sustainable position in terms of BBC Scotland and in terms of how we use the quota?
The example I would give is going back to 1930s when we did have the Edie levy and quotas for British films and so on. And what that led to around a decade later in the 1940s was what's sometimes described as the golden age of British cinema. Now, when I look round Edinburgh at the moment and look at the multiplex cinemas, I see it's completely dominated by Hollywood product. And there's not a great deal of competition. It's usually the same film which is on a number of different screens. I personally, although this would be seen as authoritarian, would like one screen in each multiplex cinema to be ring-fenced for British or Scottish or international productions. So the idea of having a quota is a good one because it ensures that you get the right kind of training for the creative industries personnel. So keep quotas for the moment, but maybe make them greater.
Yeah, and if quotas are accompanied by longer-term strategic development to enable a relatively stable media production centre, they're fine. But if they're a substitute for strategy and building an infrastructure, they're really not useful. They're a way of avoiding it, actually. I mean, it seems to me that what we keep having with Scottish broadcasting are short-term tactical solutions to replace an absence of strategy.
I think that is fundamentally where we're trying to get to. I mean, effectively, the quotas at the moment, if you take the Matchlight example and some of the other evidence submitted to the committee, it's about effectively meeting the rules but not actually delivering a long-term strategy and investment in Scottish production.
Yeah,
it would seem to me.
I mean, and I think for that reason, it seems to me to be quite dangerous to place the question of the future development of Scottish broadcasting inside a wrapper marked future of the BBC. Mm. That's the wrong way around. You know, I think the future of the BBC in Scotland should be in a wrapper marked the future of Scottish broadcasting. And that's why I, in a sense, I think there's a slight danger. We all agree that the BBC is enormously important. It's a huge cultural asset. We want it to survive. But at the same time, I think there's a slight danger in Scotland that we think that is synonymous with the future of Scottish broadcasting, and it might not be. Because, for example, I've just thought experiment here. If we did have an autonomous channel set up by the BBC, if such a thing were possible in Scotland, it would be happening at a time when the BBC's very funding base, UK-wide, is under attack. It wouldn't be a good start. There might not be a good start.
But it might improve things enormously in Scotland.
It might.
Mark.
Thanks, Peter. Convener, I have just a couple of brief questions about how the BBC meet the needs and demands of the Scottish audience, and particularly how well they research the needs and demands of the Scottish audience. Just to ask, do you have any knowledge of any of the research base as to how the specific interests of the different regions of Scotland, the needs and demands of those different regions, are measured?
I have seen my own first-hand research
and knowledge of conducting audience research for the BBC is now so historic that I would have to say that I don't know how they're doing it now. I mean, I know in the past, having conducted that kind of research myself, that we did, I mean, but I'm talking for Charter Review for 1996. I mean, what we did exactly was go into a whole lot of Scottish regions, actually, and sample in about 100 different places, but you would have to ask the BBC in what detail they're doing that now. I simply don't know the answer to that.
Research is generally a snapshot, and I know the BBC have undertaken research on the advisability or the proposal for a Scottish Six, and usually that research has not come back with figures which give enough support for it. But my response to that would be, well, of course, because that's just one pilot programme and it takes time. The history of the BBC is that the best programmes that they produce sometimes are not a success immediately. Only Fools and Horses, for example, or Monty Python and a range of others. And they take time to develop over a period of time for the audience to like it and for the creative personnel to hit their stride. So research helps, but what we need is a BBC and BBC Scotland with confidence to make the programmes not just that people want, but that they don't know they need. But once they do hit their stride, they become great successes.
With Professor Blain in particular, you've spoken about an additional channel. And do you think an additional English language TV channel falls into that category that we've just spoken about, that people want it but they don't know they want it? Or is there any evidence, is there an evidence base that suggests there is a demand for an additional Scotland-only English language TV
channel? There's evidence of considerable dissatisfaction with what we've got now. So the question is, what's the best solution? Now, I do think that one of the thoughts behind the SBC recommendation in 2008 was actually that was that this might be helpful to the BBC. And I mean, I've tried to say this in my own submission, that you might get the BBC off the hook if the BBC funded, or even largely funded, we're not talking huge sums here, a channel which it didn't run. And in fact, because I actually think there's an argument which says that whatever the BBC does in Scotland is going to keep on being criticised. And that one model through which the BBC could avoid that is be a visible funder of a channel which answers. And it would actually, in my view, take some of the heat off the BBC. It might not be a bad solution for the BBC. And it would not actually involve a restructuring of the BBC's organisation which would otherwise threaten its critical mass. So I would have thought that might be not entirely an unattractive proposition. So, I mean, do we know if... all I can say is that I know that both for the Broadcasting Commission and for the Digital Network Panel, which followed it up, you know, we did ask enormous numbers of people, but I wasn't on the Broadcasting Commission, I was in the follow-up. But in terms of popular, I mean, I'm not sure if I know the answer to your question. I only know that there is dissatisfaction at present and that people say that they want Scotland served better in terms of broadcasting provision.
There is dissatisfaction, but I don't think there's strong evidence that there's a desire for another channel. And the research that was done by the Broadcasting Commission goes back to 2008. And since then, consumption patterns have changed quite a bit, and I think also at least some consideration might need to be given to what the effects of another channel would be, for example, on BBC Alba, and just what is sustainable within Scotland. Also, you know, what the effects might also be on STV as the commercial incumbent. So I think if the argument is to be strong, then we certainly would need strong evidence for a desire for that channel, and also to know in some detail what kinds of things would work. I mean, inevitably you can't cover all the bases, and demand is not going to be clearly articulated, but we really don't know very much about that, and I do think that's an area that's been under-discussed. And so much of the debate, you know, quite reasonably, has been about Scotland's creative economy and sustaining that, and building up for example, commissioning power, but the desires of the audience really have not been part of the debate, actually.
I fully agree with Philip here, sorry, very briefly, because Philip's right in saying there may not be a demand for a channel, but there is a demand for content that reflects our lives. Man, and taking what Mary Scanlon said to me earlier, woman, cannot live by still game alone. But why is still game so successful? It's because it puts on the screen the life of ordinary people in Glasgow and ordinary people in Aberdeen, in Inverness, in Dundee and in Edinburgh also want to see programmes which speak to them, for them and about them. And a channel would be one way of producing
two very quick responses to that. One is that people in millions are still watching television channels in real time. And the other one is that, for example, the Irish language channel is not threatened by the existence of a number of other channels in Ireland. And I take Philip's point, but I think if you, and I agree with him about changing viewing patterns, but if you were to say to people in Catalonia or Ireland, can you give your channels back because you're consuming more of your media content online, you would get a very robust response. I mean, I make the point that, in fact, in the Republic of Ireland, another channel has started broadcasting last Saturday. So there is clearly, I think the last thing we need to worry about in Scotland is channel proliferation. You know, we've got two opt-out broadcasters in BBC Alpa. I would not be worried about a glut of channels, quite the opposite.
Can I just check, finally, with Philip, you said that you would have to be clear before we launched this, an extra channel or a new channel, that there was a demand for that channel. I mean, how do you measure demand for a new channel, given that people demand more programming, as I think others have said, they demand new content. They don't necessarily format it in their demand for a new channel.
No, I agree with you.
Secondly, could you tell us what demand was there for the launch of BBC 3 and BBC 4 before BBC launched those channels? I don't remember a huge demand for those channels.
No, I don't remember any public demand for those channels at all.
No, neither do I.
There tends not to be. I mean, BBC Alpa would be a specialised example where there was an obvious demand, but mainly there isn't. You're right.
Thank you very much. Can I thank you all for coming this morning and giving your time to us? I'm going to suspend briefly.
If I can now move on to our next panel, and of course we're having this in a slightly different format, in a round table format. Can I welcome to the committee Janet Archer from Creative Scotland, John Archer from Independent Producers Scotland, Donald Campbell from MG Alapa, Paul Holleran, NUG Scotland, Bill Matthews, Audience Council Scotland, and Paul McManus from BEC2. Can I welcome you all to the committee this morning? We're going to try and cover some of the same ground, obviously, that we've just been through with the previous panel. It's not obviously a panel as such, so it's quite happy for people to intervene and hopefully join in the conversation rather than a strict committee members' questions and panel answers. So hopefully we'll be able to get a bit more of a free-flowing discussion going in the next hour and a quarter or so. But I want to begin, we did before, and ask Colin Beattie to kick us off with the governance and accountability issue.
Yeah, with the previous panel, we had a bit of a discussion on federalism, the appropriateness of federalism, what federalism indeed meant. But there was a consensus about more devolution in the widest sense being needed in terms of BBC in Scotland. And I'd be interested to know what people feel about the pros and cons of a federal structure and how it might look.
And if you could try and keep your answer reasonably short, that would be appreciated. And who wants to start us off on this? Yes, Bill.
Thank you very much. Happy New Year to the committee. I think the fascinating evidence earlier on from the three professors, and I think there was a resounding impression left that the word federalism means lots of different things to different people, so we need to be really, really careful how we use it. If I speak from my position as chair of the Audience Council in Scotland, I think if you had asked audience members, and I do an awful lot of consultation with audiences, do they want federalism? I think you get quite a lot of blank looks. I think if you said to them, do you want more content that represents your lives in Scotland and gives you news and current affairs that speaks to you, that you feel that the BBC in Scotland is the BBC for the audience in Scotland much more, I think the answer would probably be a quite resounding yes. So I think the terminology is difficult, and I think there's a level of detail when we start talking about governance and structure that in my other role as BBC trustee for Scotland, we're engaged with the David Clementi review, which is in fact looking into structure, governance and accountability. And we as national trustees have not yet met with him, but we meet with him in the next few days. So I don't want to prejudice any of that discussion. The devil in it would be in the detail, I think. But if we take that back to audiences, I think audiences would be quite keen to see more of their own lives reflected in what they see and hear on BBC output.
Okay, thank you. John?
I agree with that. I think essentially in Scotland for broadcast production, we're chronically underdeveloped. We are subject to the imperial power of London. We are a colony. And I think we're at the position that Churchill was after the Second World War when he said, we can't let the colonies rule themselves. We have to control them. And I think we deserve better. I don't think the BBC in London get the new Scotland. I think we need a radical change and shift in emphasis. I don't think we need any quick fixes. We need something which is bold. I think we do need the equivalent or better of the Scottish Parliament and Westminster. We need some freedom. The money raised in Scotland should be spent from Scotland. Scotland should decide what is made here. Money does give power. And in broadcasting, the ability to say yes is all important. Nobody at BBC Scotland can say yes to a network production. That's terrible. We deserve better. And I think we should imagine better for Scotland.
Thank you. Paul?
I think there is a real requirement for a federal structure. I'm not too sure how that would pan out. But there's no point in having that level of accountability unless there are resources there. And as John says, I think it is key, the whole thing is key to how much money that BBC Scotland have to spend. And in that way, decision-making in Scotland, for Scotland, and also for a wider BBC, would be far more effective. And there's no point in having a federal structure if we still have to go cap in hand to London and beg them for changes and for more resources. The resources are the main issue, but a federal structure would at least allow us to make more decisions in Scotland that would then benefit a wider BBC as well.
Can I take one point that Bill just made there about what do we mean by federalism? I mean, we heard from the first panel various views on what this actually means, about whether or not it's actually federalism, whether the impact on the rest of the UK of a federal structure in Scotland, what would that be? And are we talking about decentralisation, or are you actually talking about federalism?
Well, I suppose there's a bit of both. There's a crossover, clear crossover. I don't think you can separate the impact. Well, I would hope that you wouldn't separate the impact that spending in Scotland would have on the rest of a BBC, a federal BBC structure, because we would be quite keen that programmes made in Scotland would be going onto the network. So there needs to be a close-knit operation across the whole of the BBC, the nations and the regions. I think part of the trouble is that we have a London centricity that is unacceptable. And with more decision-making in the nations and regions, more resources in the nations and regions to make local and national and international programmes, then that need for a federal structure would be required rather than just a decentralisation. Because there's no doubt about it that the links need to be maintained in respect to the programme making, the commissioning, and obviously the links with independent television producers as well.
Okay. Colin.
Yep. Again, when I spoke to the previous panel, an integral part of whether you have a federal structure, whether you have devolution, an integral part of this question is tied up in the actual oversight, the accountability of what the BBC does in Scotland, what it spends in Scotland, and so forth. And the question is, do we have an adequate accountability at the moment? Would a federal structure bring us better accountability? Is it necessary to have a federal structure to have that greater accountability? What would that greater accountability actually boil down to?
Paul.
Yeah, I think from listening to this last part of the previous debate and also the opening comments in this debate, I think we need to be very careful about generalising too much. I mean, in the first few minutes, what we've heard here is a call for much greater decision-making in terms of what's made in Scotland, what's spent in Scotland, and very quickly jumped that across to, you know, demands placed on what would go on the UK network. I think we would share the concerns and the views that there has to be much greater accountability in Scotland, to Scotland, about what the BBC does. There has to be much greater control over what BBC Scotland does within Scotland. I think in terms of UK network spend, then you're talking about an agreement with other bodies about what Scottish production would be broadcast at a UK-wide level. And I think it's dangerous just to generalise very quickly in terms of just smashing the two things together and saying we want more of everything. The means to achieve those different things would be through different methods. I think we would also have to be careful about, in terms of the federalist question, about we would certainly be looking at more of a decentralisation. We're not offering a solution on what the federalism would look like, but I think it's important never to forget that BBC Scotland and other parts of the BBC benefit enormously from economies of scale across the whole of the UK. And to go too far down one road of saying, you know, we're going to completely isolate one element of the BBC could have an enormous impact on that, you know, in a negative way.
Okay, Liam?
Yeah, I mean, it follows on from Paul's comments to an extent. I was interested that the three panellists we had in the first session all were at pains, I think, right at the outset to nail their colours to the mast as BBC loyalists. And I think it was interesting but actually very helpful in that I think some of the voices in the debate at a UK level make no secret of the fact that they see no relevance for a BBC going forward. I would say there are some voices within the debate in Scotland who, coming at it from a different perspective, probably have a similar endgame in mind. So it would be helpful to know from the contributors here whether there's a common view that the BBC as an entity, albeit reformed in whatever way people see fit, is something that we need to hold on to and value.
Okay. John?
It's the most important cultural institution in the UK, and I think it should be in Scotland. It probably is, but we just want it to be better. We want it to make programmes that connect better with the audience in Scotland, and also want to see it play its part in building the production industry here. The lift and shift, as you've discussed, was a quick fix, but that was 9 years ago. I mean, as a quick fix, they've become addicted to it. It's like a dangerous drug, and they need to get off it pretty quickly because it's not helping the industry here.
Okay. Donald.
Yeah, well, quite clearly, the BBC is massively important. It's important for the culture, for democracy, for the economy, even. And the BBC Trust's recent proposals to add the BBC as one to the public purposes of the BBC as an enabler of economic growth, I think, is very, very important. If you take two massive brand assets, I think, the BBC and Scotland, and you put them together, you think what a powerful combination you could have and should have on an international stage. So if you think of, if you ask the question, well, what should a federated or a devolved or decentralised BBC look like from Scotland, you think, well, put those two things together and test it from the international perspective. Colleagues of mine were at an international content market in April of last year. There were 83 from the Republic of Ireland there. There were over 100 each from Denmark, Sweden, Finland and Norway there. There were less than 10 from Scotland. And you think, well, why? Now, I think that with decision-making and financial accountability in Scotland, with a BBC worldwide, which was not just working out of London, but a BBC Scotland worldwide, you'd have fantastic, tremendous potential.
Okay, thank you. Paul McManus.
Again, coming back to the point of the generalisation, I was, you know, particularly dismayed by some of the comments about lift and shift operations. And again, I think, for the purpose of the debate, we need to be very clear about what we're talking about. I'm quite sure producers in Scotland are hugely opposed to lift and shift operations, but I would be dismayed, and our members would be deeply upset, if anybody was suggesting that the likes of the Weakest Link, Waterloo Road, which provided months and months of high-quality work to many hundreds of freelancers working in Scotland, should not be brought here. At the end of the day, our members, the thousands of people who work in the industry in Scotland, want to work in Scotland, and any prospect or any idea that production should not be brought here because there's some debate about where all the money goes would be hugely horrifying to them. Yes, we want a strong producer base in Scotland, but we also want a lot of high-quality work in Scotland. So, you know, we will take Waterloo Road, we will take the Weakest Link, because it keeps the studios in Glasgow busy and it keeps our members working. And also, from those productions, our members have also been put onto a number of network productions. They've gone out to work in the likes of the Olympic Games with BBC London to gain more experience. So again, if we're talking about building the producer base in Scotland, then that's fine. If we're talking about work for people in Scotland, that's a different thing. So I think, again, we need to be careful there.
There's a number of people want in, but I'm slightly puzzled, Paul, by that contribution. I mean, if we build the producer base, if we build the indigenous industry, surely we build jobs for your members and more members.
Yes, absolutely. But that doesn't mean we want to have a holistic approach. I think, as Paul made the comment, we want to be taking our products out with Scotland as well. There's a danger, just as with the film studios, the comment was made over the years, we've had the debate about Scottish film studios, and the industry has universally agreed the Scottish industry could not sustain a film studio in Scotland. What Scotland could sustain is a commercial studio operation which sells its products abroad and which helps build the industry in Scotland. Equally within the television industry, we want a strong producer base which will eventually, in the longer term, increase employment levels. But in the short to medium term, what we are saying is we should not be opposing bringing products to Scotland. Just any organisation in Scotland, any Scottish company, will look to bring work to its workforce in Scotland, and that's what we are saying. The Weakest Link was not a Scottish concept, it was not a Scottish idea. It provided a lot of work to a lot of people in Scotland. And over a longer term strategy, yes, we can build up the producer base and build up the indigenous producers and the work that comes from them, but we should not discount bringing work to Scotland.
Okay, John Archer.
The formats you mentioned effectively came to Scotland to die, sadly. And they didn't leave any residue. The producers went home to London And the people who worked on them here were left looking for other work. If those projects had been developed here, the IP would have stayed here, which would have been invested in further productions and further work for your members. I think, the example you gave is just about the worst that there was.
No, I disagree. Convener, if we can just answer that point. And again, it goes to the commissioning process as well. In my experience, if you look at the levels of work that have been in BBC Scotland, they directly correlate to who is the head of that genre in Scotland. If you look at the periods when there's been high levels of drama in Scotland, there has been a particularly successful and strong head of drama in Scotland, regardless of where the commissioning was. It's the same in entertainment, it's the same in factual, and it's the same in children's. Where there's a good head of department in Scotland, Scotland gets the work. Where there is not a good head of department, then Scotland doesn't get the work. So I think there's more to it than just blaming the commissioning process.
So I don't want to interrupt myself, but I mean, isn't that part of the problem, Paul? That effectively we're continually fighting to ask for work from somebody else, when if the decision-making process and the budget and the commissioning decision-making process was in Scotland, then the work would be there. Isn't that the fundamental
I don't disagree that if there was more control in Scotland over more money, then yes, clearly there would be more work in Scotland. But we can point to periods in history, and they've been mentioned in the various submissions about the mid-90s, the early 2000s. It wasn't the commissioning process directly that led to those increases in work. It was a strong and creative head of drama. Some of that work was network commissions, which we're in danger of losing if we isolate them. I'm not saying we shouldn't have more control and more money in Scotland. Yes, we should. But at the same point, we have to be careful about disenfranchising ourselves from the network.
I don't think I'm just saying that, Paul. But anyway, but Paul Holleran and then George Adam.
Just in response to Liam's question about commitment to the BBC, I think the BBC has enemies in a number of areas. Rupert Murdoch's organisation, for example. The newspaper industry see the BBC as rivals, which I think is a really unhealthy situation. I think there's a lack of partnership approach on both sides. I think one of the dangers for the BBC, or BBC Scotland in particular, is if there is no change. It's quite gratifying to hear Bill saying that there is discussions about to start about the new management structure, because there is a need for that more than anything. But if you look at the submission that BBC Scotland management put together as part of this, the original Charter Renewal bid, the NUJ in particular were pleasantly surprised how ambitious they were, but it was with a view to saying that we want £150 million to spend in Scotland. We will expand our news and current affairs coverage. We will make more drama. We will put more music programmes on. Here's our plan. And after the budgetary discussions, it was totally kicked into the long grass. And I think that is unacceptable. And that's why we welcome this debate. And I think that's the type of argument we need to get into, to A, look at the management decisions, the budgetary decisions, how much budget is spent in Scotland, like the previous three guests where speakers were talking about before. That type of budgetary decision needs to be taken, as well as the management structures. But if we had budgets that BBC Scotland were looking for, then I'm quite sure that there would be less need for lifting and shifting. But I mean, at the moment, I can see where Bechtu's concerns would be that if that work doesn't come here, then there's a real dearth of work for their members and other trade union members. However, if there's a larger budget and there's more control over how that spending is carried out, then I think we'd be in a far more advanced situation. I think a larger share of the money raised in Scotland and being kept in Scotland to make local programmes, but also for the national network and even on an international market. I think the quality of our independent sector is there to be seen by everyone. And I think a closer partnership there between the BBC and that sector can raise the game for broadcasting in Scotland.
Thank you. George?
Yeah, I think we're involved down in the weakest link in everything we've discussed on Waterloo Road, but there's other examples that have been mentioned today with regard to the commissioning. The example that was mentioned earlier on was Doctor Who to BBC Wales, and it's the quality of the product and what you get back. Now, there's a series that's been going for 10 years. Now, the difference was that went to Wales,
because the BBC wanted Russell T Davies to do it, and he says, I'm only going to do it if I do it in Wales. And what I'm trying to say here is the fact that it's about, you know, if we're talking about what we're actually putting out there, what does the Scots audience want? Does the commissioning make the difference? I think that's a perfect example. Why can't we go back to the time where we had, and I'm slightly biased, being from Paisley, John Byrne's Tutti Frutti in 1987, you know, drama that was very successful both from a creative point of view and also, I believe it was networked as well. So you've got that. You've got Crow Road in the mid-90s as well. The Crow Road, Ian Banks' Crow Road. You know, why are we not getting to a place where we in Scotland can actually get product that we want? And it isn't just the still game scenario where we're watching, because it's the only thing that comes from anything that we relate to as well. You know, is it the commissioning? Is it the fact that one of the ideas that was brought up by Professor Beveridge was, he said it was quite radical, get BBC Two and BBC Four in their entirety, one of them to come up to Scotland and commission everything from here. Is that a way forward? Is that a way for us to look at things? You know, because when you talk to people, they just want to see content that relates to their life and how they go forward. So is it not about more the long-term goal, something that's sustainable that we can get instead of getting the scraps like Waterloo Road and kind of the Weakest Link?
Next then, Gordon.
Paul raised a couple of minutes ago where he said that BBC Scotland were quite ambitious about expanding programming, including news. In the submission that we've got from the BBC, they've said the BBC believes it's time to come for it to strike a better balance between the delivery of pan-UK news and news tailored to the distinctive needs and agenda of the devolved nations. And I was just wondering how that fitted with the fact that you're saying all of that has been cut.
Do you want to answer that, Paul?
Yep. Well, there's two aspects. One, I suppose I'd refer back to the start of 2014, when people knew what was coming in 2015 in Scotland, where we had the Commonwealth Games, the Ryder Cup, the commemoration of the start of World War One, and, of course, the independence referendum. And decisions were taken to introduce massive swinging cuts in BBC Scotland at the start of that year. And that, to me, you know, there's no logic in that decision whatsoever. Moving on, we're then in a position where the submission for the charter renewal from BBC Scotland management, and Ken Macquarie has you know, addressed the workforce on this. He spoke to the workforce and the unions and explained the ambitious plans. And both of you, I believe, is given evidence next week, BBC management, apparently came out of one of the meetings and said there is now nothing for the nations and regions. Now, who made that decision? Who made that decision just to back off completely from quite ambitious plans, which I believe were being seriously considered, but then told, no, it's been kicked into the long grass? And it's not just about Scotland. It's about, you know, it's about Wales. It's about Northern Ireland. It's about, you know, the knock-on effect throughout the whole of the BBC, and that's why I think a federated structure will work. But the decision-making process in respect to budgets and where they're spent is something that is, to me, is a serious danger to the future of the BBC.
Okay. Bill?
If I can go back to the question that Liam asked a little while ago about loyalties, I'd probably get a front page if the BBC trustee and audience council chair said he wasn't a fan of the BBC and a fan of public service broadcasting. And I think it's a fantastic organisation, but it doesn't get it right all the time, and there are many places you can point to where I'm sure it could do better. If I can pull this conversation back to what audiences maybe want, because I think that's quite important too. If you look at the data, audiences in Scotland consume a lot of BBC output, whether online, on TV or on radio, and it's not dissimilar to what the rest of the UK as an average consumes. In TV, it's actually a little bit more. They tend to appreciate it a little bit less than the rest of the UK, which is the important point for me for the Audience Council. And I boil it down into two main areas where I think there is work to be done. And I don't know that these are areas that need to wait for a charter review to be fixed, but we happen to be there, and now's a good time to talk about it. I think provision of news and current affairs for the Scottish audience is really important. And I think that it's become increasingly difficult for the editors of our network news programmes to put together a succinct bulletin that addresses the needs of every corner of the UK. So I think I welcome Tony's recognition in writing to Scottish Government and the other devolved administrations seeking some views on how the BBC can do that better. I'm sure he'll talk a little bit more about that next week when he's here. The second part of it is about representing and portrayal of the audience that the BBC is serving. And that's about recognising the distinct culture of Scotland, recognising the lives that people live in Scotland. It's about representing the Gaelic culture as well. And that's all down for me to the commissioning process and how commissioning works is still, after 10 years in and around the BBC as a volunteer and as a member of the Trust, is still a bit of a mystery. It surely shouldn't be that we depend on where somebody is located or who somebody is to get the best of all of the UK out of the commissioning process. So there's something about building a process that works. And we're dealing with all of this in a decreasing financial envelope. The BBC has saved £1.6 billion over the period of this charter. And we're dealing with this in an environment where bits of England probably don't think they're represented even as well as Scotland, and there are similar debates going on in Wales and Northern Ireland. So for me, there's an issue about how we align the commissioning process, perhaps through a purpose in the new charter to more effectively represent all of the UK within the BBC's output.
Thank you. Chick.
Yes, thank you. Interestingly, Paul Holleran, he mentioned one word, which is internationalisation. I get the feeling today that we're in this UK bubble and how we're going to transfer production, etc. If I look at Outlander, which is not for BBC, in terms of its export capability, and perhaps Janet can make some comment, given that the Economy Committee looked at exports in the creative industries, or I look at, as I mentioned, Outlander and other cases where we have the capability to export. I get this terrible feeling of, apart from the structure, which we've got to talk about, this retrenchment, this idea that this is the bubble. I know they do export, but not to the extent, and we have this retrenchment mentioned earlier about how do we cut costs, what do we do there, and not enough emphasis on using the talent that we have in Scotland in terms of the production and through commissioning of what the market, further market would take. We're not just doing that. We're living, I tend to, my view, I'm happy to be proved wrong, that we're living in this bubble. We're talking about a BBC overall UK and what we need to do in BBC Scotland. And I think the way you do that is you do actually federalise or regionalise and release the talent that's available in each of the areas of the UK and start looking to become a bit more assertive in what we can do. If Denmark can do it with Bergen, I'm sure we can do it with other programmes. And just the point that Professor Beveridge made earlier about the Hollywood idea, I think, given outside, I think Frozen should have been produced in Scotland.
Paul?
Just to pick up Bill's point, first of all, in terms of the commissioning process, I think you'll find is a mystery to most BBC managers as well, and it's a process that Bechtu has been hugely critical of. I don't ever recall being at a meeting where we would have a clear answer from the BBC, and I think Paul will back me up on this, about what's actually happening at any given stage in the commissioning process. You just got a shrug of the shoulders, and it's all down to the commissioning process. So anything that could help improve that process would be helpful. But again, going back to the comments made by George about the likes of Tutti Frutti and other popular programmes, again, they were made at a time when there was a strong head of department in Scotland who championed those programmes and who fought for them. And they shouldn't have to fight for Scottish content and Scottish output. The support should be there. But the more important point I wanted to make was in relation to talk about, taking over BBC Two or BBC Four. Again, going back to Paul's comments, we're in a situation where the BBC may not have BBC Two or BBC Four for much longer, given the licence fee, the proposed licence fee settlement and the charter renewal discussions. The BBC is facing losing a fifth of its budget over the next 5 or 6 years, and we're talking about real cuts, real closures of service, and many thousands of jobs going. And I think we can't lose sight of that in terms of the debate we're having about what we want from the BBC going forward. I think it was perhaps yourself that made the comment, Stuart, this is probably the ideal time to have the conversation about what Scotland should get out of the process going forward, but we can't lose sight of the many hundreds of millions of pounds. The BBC's effectively been told to hand over a blank cheque in terms of the over 75 provision, and I think that's something the committee can't lose sight of.
Okay, thank you. Janet, there's a challenge thrown down, I think, by Chick there about the role of Creative Scotland, but I think there is a question mark about what is Creative Scotland's role here in terms of the small independent producers and the industry in general, and what role it has in terms of what it expects to get out of the charter renewal process.
Yes, and I mean, obviously that's a very good question. Creative Scotland is an organisation with about 100 people in it, and the BBC, I think, has something like 1,000 or maybe a bit more, so that just gives a sense of the proportionality of scale. But nevertheless, I think we have the scope for influence and injecting some thinking about potential for the future and innovation for the future in a context where the broadcasting landscape is changing. And we heard earlier from the previous panel about the different ways that audiences are consuming content. Young people very rarely look at a television screen. I think they're much more interested in other kinds of platforms, and we've got to take that into account in terms of how we think about policy for the future. But on the international point, I think that's a very good point. I think there's a phrase that's used in the BBC Studios proposition as it stands. It talks about local-only content that has relevance to a particular place. And I would argue that in Scotland's instance, because there's so much interest in Scotland globally from so many people who have connections back into Scotland, that actually you might be able to use your local-only as much more of a global proposition. And you can start to think about local-global in a very tangible way. So it's that sort of thinking that I think we should be doing. Our focus in thinking about this is fairly straightforward. It's about greater commissioning power for Scotland, from Scotland. It's about that point that was made about IP and finding a way of negotiating more opportunity for Scottish indies to be able to benefit from the IP that they generate. Often that just gets lost, I think, in the way that things work at the moment. It's not good enough, I don't think. I think we all feel that there could be better representation of Scotland's culture on BBC platforms. Clearly, lots of views in terms of what that actually might mean in practice. But nevertheless, even I feel, as someone who moved to Scotland just 2.5 years ago now, I feel that I don't see as much as I would like to see in respect of the extraordinary things that happen in this nation in as prominent way as they could be seen. And that's certainly a conversation that we have with the BBC and will continue to have with the BBC through all of the different relationships that we hold. The BBC is clearly an important... It could make a huge deal of difference if it chose to, and if the hearts and minds argument that was discussed earlier were won. I think there needs to be better systems of accountability. We've talked about what that might look like in practice, but I've noticed that the structure... For me, it's not just about governance, it's also about the day-to-day management of how things are run. And at the moment, I'm noticing that there's an executive board and there's an executive team. And as far as I can see, Ken Macquarie sits on the executive team, not on the executive board. So potential for a small shift there that might make quite a big bit of difference when it comes to those decisions that were being discussed and in relation to news or other things. So I think there are day-to-day small shifts that could happen in terms of getting more out of what we've got now, as well as thinking about the bigger picture and what that might look like for the future.
Thank you very much, John.
I'd just like to say on the drama point, there was great drama in the 1990s, the Tutti Frutti taking over the asylum. And it's about money, again. After those things were made, the money for drama in Scotland, which had sat in Scotland and was decided on in discussion with London, went to London. After that, the drama that we've had from Scotland has been much poorer. It's true, Paul. What are the great dramas of the last 20 years?
look again, if you look at when there hasn't been great damage, John, and look at who was in charge of drama in Scotland, there's a direct correlation.
But
if you look at when there was great drama, then there was a strong head of drama.
But the money was here, and then it went back to London. And I very much enjoyed watching Capital, the John Lanchester novel about the housing market in London, which was on the BBC in September. But how much more would I have enjoyed watching a dramatisation on the BBC of something like James Robertson's The Land Lay Still, which might have explained something about the whole devolution debate and vote of 18 months ago. That kind of thing is not getting on to the BBC, and it should. The UK is the poorer for it.
James has played as an example of Rona Munro's fantastic plays, which won, I think, the Evening Standard's Best New Play Award, but we haven't seen those broadcast as yet.
Thank you. Blain, I'm going to bring you in and to move us on to the incoming expenditure stuff, Gordon, if you don't mind. But Liam.
Point. I mean, you will not be surprised that, coming from Orkney, I'm slightly apprehensive when there's discussion of the Scottish culture. I mean, clearly, Donald will speak to the success of BBC Alba and reflecting a different image of Scotland. But there is a risk that it becomes quite binary. It's either Gaelic or it's a kind of central belt perception of Scotland. And therefore, I think throughout this, is there space for some sort of debate about the wider reflection of the diversity of culture from north to south, from east to west in Scotland? I mean, there have been good examples. I mean, Shetland would tap into the Scandic noir, even if it isn't necessarily an accurate portrayal of what goes on in Shetland. Trawler, again, has given a rather industrial bird's eye view to what happens in the fishing industry in the northeast. So there are good examples of that, but I think the concern I would have is that when one talks about Scottish culture from the perspective of those in the Highlands and Islands, I suspect similarly in the southwest and in the borders, there'll be a concern that that is very much a view from sort of Pacific Key, or from the offices of the Edinburgh Festival, for example, rather than necessarily something that reflects the messiness and the diversity of culture across Scotland.
Okay, thank you, Gordon. I want to open up some of the discussion we had at the previous panel on the issue about the income and expenditure and how it currently operates, or, well, do we even know how it currently operates? Mm. Given the information that we have at the moment or don't have at the moment. And Gordon, you led us off in the previous panel on that issue.
I think it was actually Mary, but I'm quite happy.
Well, sorry, I do apologise. Mary, it was you. I do apologise, Mary.
It was me, yes.
I do apologise. Sorry, Gordon.
I thought
Mary.
I'd sit here quietly.
that's what threw me, Mary.
Break the habit of a lifetime. Can I just first of all say that I think what the committee, what I would really want to do is to put forward a very positive suggestion. This is a brilliant opportunity to have an input into the BBC Charter, and I would hope that what we put forward, and I hope that we can have a debate in the Parliament, and I hope that it's a very positive debate. In future, the Audit Committee will obviously be looking at the BBC Scotland's annual accounts. They'll be looking at how effectively that money is spent. They'll be looking at the money raised in Scotland and production and quotas and whatever else in Scotland. But in the absence of that, and can I also say the Audit Committee amended the Memorandum of Understanding, so we've already had a significant input. So my question, I'll just lump it together, is to say, I appreciate that the Audit Committee, we haven't had the annual accounts yet, but I just really want a comment about where we are on audit. This is something completely new, given this Parliament was set up in 1999. But in terms of accountability, etc., if I could just ask, what proportion of the licence fee would you like to see spent in Scotland? This would be obviously a precursor to how we should be auditing and monitoring. Are quotas an effective measure? We've heard differing views from the previous panel. Or is it just an artificial market? We've heard from people here about commissioning is quite a mystery. If that's a mystery, that means it's very difficult for quotas. I would like to see something going forward that would include the independent producers. And personally, I don't find your talk of imperial power very helpful in this context, but never mind. But what other options would you find sustainable for the production sector in Scotland? And just finally, to roll it all together, Convener, should the charter, because this is an opportunity for us to have input into this charter, should it enshrine a specific quota for network production? Or what positive point do you want to ensure that we have more Scottish culture, more jobs in Scotland, more reflection of how we live in Scotland? How can we ensure that that is enshrined moving forward in future? And can I just say that I do commend the BBC, and particularly BBC Alba, on the coverage of the Maud. That is phenomenal. The traditional music and song, and also the pipe band championships. And somebody mentioned Glastonbury earlier. Bella Drum, which is the Highlands equivalent of Tea in the Park, is regularly on BBC Alba, and a lot of local talent there as well. And can I just say that your recognition and commitment to traditional music, pipe bands, etc. in Scotland is far greater than Creative Scotland, where it's barely even on the agenda. So that's my question, great, all in one.
And there's a lot of it. But before I bring in Paul Holleran, just for clarity, Mary, I mean, there is nothing in the Memorandum of Understanding that says that BBC will provide BBC Scotland accounts to this Parliament.
Yes, there is.
No, there's not. No, and if you look at the Memorandum of Understanding, that's not what it says.
The Memorandum of Understanding, as I understand it, well, I think we'd have to get it and have a good look at it, is that BBC Scotland's accounts will come to the Scottish Parliament's Audit Committee.
No, what it says is...
Because we would have no locus on UK BBC.
No, what it says is it will submit the BBC's annual report and the BBC's accounts.
That's right.
Not BBC Scotland's accounts. There is no such thing as BBC Scotland's accounts. That is the fundamental question. I raise it because I think there's an issue here. We shouldn't be misled that there is a separate set of BBC Scotland accounts that are produced that would allow us to analyse.
There's no reason why, you know, we can look for the breakdown of BBC Scotland's income and expenditure within those accounts. That's what the Audit Committee does week on week.
That does not prohibit us
from getting that information.
No, I absolutely agree with that. It's just to make sure that we're clear. The Memorandum of Understanding doesn't say that specifically, but I think you're absolutely right.
But the Audit Committee is capable enough of seeking that information.
Okay, go on.
You know, question 10 that we submitted to the BBC just before Christmas, we said, could BBC Scotland provide its annual accounts and or a statement of its financial activities in 2014-15? And they basically said it doesn't exist. Consideration is currently being given as to how statistical information pertaining to each of the nations, including Scotland, may best be incorporated and presented within the BBC annual report and accounts in the future.
That's fine. That's exactly what we're
looking
for.
But it doesn't exist. That's the point.
No, but it's going to be there in the future, and that's what it's all about.
Well, it may be, but I think that's what part of the argument. Yeah. But anyway, Paul Holleran has been waiting patiently.
Do you think that's part of the accountability where BBC Scotland is made available? I'm sure it'll come in the future. In respect to proportion of how much money should be retained in Scotland, I mean, the submission from BBC Scotland management to the original bid for as part of Charter Renewal was £150 million, which is less than 50%. I'm not sure how they came to that figure, but I'm sure it'll be there for negotiation for the future, but it would be a starting position. And I also think the quotas would be part of a support structure and leading into that as well in respect to discussions across the broadcasting industry, including the independent companies and including STV with the BBC on how those programmes are made. But I do think it needs to be part of an agreement, whether it comes with the federal structure or whatever, decentralisation, but that there should be an agreement reached on a fixed amount of money to be retained in Scotland. And I'm just back from Spain last night, and I noticed that there's a new station there, Andalusia, which feeds in from every, you know, from Cadiz right the way through to Granada, from Seville down to Malaga. Constant news, and they provide just constant news and cultural magazine programmes 24 hours a day. It's a new station that's been set up there as part of the TV España. And if they can do it, I don't see why we can't do it.
Okay, thank you. Chick Brody.
Very quickly, in terms of wherever the audit is, I can ask that the Public Audit Committee ask the question, or if we can't, they can ask the question, then we'll ask it through FOI, as to what management fee is charged by BBC, or portion of their management fee is attributed to Scotland. It'd be interesting to see what proportion of Scotland's revenue finds itself into the management fee structure of BBC UK.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask, given we're on quotas, or it was mentioned just a moment ago by Mary, for example, I mean, do people support the continuation of the quotas, even in the short to medium term? Do they think quotas are an effective way of making sure that there's money and work comes to Scotland? And if you do support quotas, do you think that the current arrangement of quotas, which is a wider quota and as an umbrella covering not just Scotland but other parts of the UK, is the way that it should be set up, or should there be some different form of quotas? Donald.
Well, the quota system has been useful to, as Paul has said already, in many ways, in bringing work to Scotland, but it has not delivered the long-term benefits and the follow-up, if you like, that it should have. So there's a certain use to quotas. Where the quotas have failed is that there's not been a strategic kind of plan underlying the quota system, which is focused on the growth of the indigenous production sector in Scotland. So with the quota system should have come a partnership strategy. How does the BBC partner with indigenous production companies and with producers in Scotland? Because the people who bring the work to Scotland are the producers. The drama producer is the person who will hire the director, who will hire the crew, the cast and crew, put everything into motion, who will work with the scriptwriters to bring the thing, the project to life. So a partnership strategy has to lie hand in hand with any quota system. Probably a better system in terms of what we're looking at would be a devolved financial accountability system where the licence fee that is raised in Scotland is accounted for by the management of the BBC in Scotland. So allow the management of the BBC in Scotland to divvy up the licence fee in a sense and say, this is how we propose to spend it. This is the bit that we'll pay for the iPlayer. This is the bit that we'll share with the infrastructure of the UK. These are the joint projects that we will do with the rest of the UK. This is what we think the audience in Scotland needs. And this is our five-year business partnership plan with the sector in Scotland to grow domestic production, for audiences in Scotland, for audiences in the UK, and audiences globally. And if the audit committee is looking for something which to measure the BBC, you could measure it on the pipeline and the co-production and the co-investment capital that's being invested by the BBC over a period of time into UK-wide and international projects, and measure the return on that as well. Because we are also in danger of being too focused on cuts, cuts, cuts all the time. What about the plan for growth? We've got enormous, enormous assets with the BBC and the Scotland brands together. You know, we need to work them.
Okay, thank you. Bill.
On the specific question of quotas, I was around as a member of the BBC Broadcasting Council when Mark Thompson made his famous network supply review speech. And I have to say, and I think my colleagues in BBC Trust would agree with this, that the network supply review, which is our internal language for the quota system that exists today, has had a positive impact. It has definitely created opportunity and talent development, skill development in Scotland. It's a bit of a hard, kind of clunky metric. And I think looking back at it now, at the point where numerically it has been achieved, I think we'd all sit back and say, well, we can design something better going forward, something that as well as looking at the impact to the economy, which is important, looking at how that spend has been spent wisely to reflect the lifestyles and the culture of Scotland. So it's going to have to be enhanced. The other thing, which there was a comment earlier, I think Robert Beveridge perhaps made it, about the
the lumpiness of the spend, that it's gone up and it's gone down over a period of time. There is something about sustainability going forward that I think we'd all want to see a sustainable production sector in Scotland. Now, I have to say, that's not only the BBC's job. There are other people involved in the sector, but the BBC is such a big part of it, it's got to play quite a leading role. But there's something, I don't know how we manage that in, but it would seem to me that whilst I certainly wouldn't favour writing percentages into a Royal Charter, there needs to be something at a higher level in there that then speaks to another commitment that's detailed elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. Paul?
Thanks, Convener. Partly to answer Liam's original question, and also hopefully to address some of Mary's points, I think we would see the current arrangement in terms of how the BBC operates in terms of percentages with the independent sector, how it operates with the rest of the UK, as being something that should be built on and moved forward, not something that should be dismantled and torn apart. I agree with the comments that Donald was making, that we should be looking at a more organic nature between independent companies and the BBC, so that the BBC can help these companies to develop and grow. And indeed, you know, Bechtu and Skillset have worked with the BBC over the past few years to on training projects to help develop producers to a level that network commissioners are happy with. So, you know, we have already, you know, in a small way, started down that path. In terms of quotas, I agree with Bill's comments that the NSR has been positive for Scotland. It's been a help to Scotland. It's brought more work to Scotland. It's disappointing that such a crude mechanism had to be kind of forced out of the BBC in the first place. And again, I would hope that in the not too distant future, any discussions, you know, leading from this committee about the funding of the BBC would lead to a more sophisticated mechanism, because I think that, you know, the quotas, as everybody else has said, are a fairly crude mechanism. They have helped, but they're not the long-term solution.
Okay, thank you. Gordon?
Just a couple of quick questions. First one is what Bill said about, obviously, bringing programmes that we've referred to as Lift and Shift to Scotland has produced jobs, and that's obviously welcome. But my question would be, if that same amount of money had been invested in Scottish-based companies where the IP and the profits would have been retained in Scotland, would that not have had a bigger and more sustainable impact on the television production sector in Scotland?
I don't know. Some of my colleagues here could probably answer that better than I can. I'll go back to my point, Gordon. I think that Mark Thompson and the BBC Trust at the time put in place a mechanism to improve TV production in Scotland, and I think it was clunky, and I think it had an effect of bringing talent, skills and people into Scotland. Now, we can debate for hours whether enough of that was spent with Scottish companies, and I'm not entirely sure what Scottish companies are, because some of the companies that started out that period as Scottish companies are probably now owned by larger, more international companies, you know. So there's a big debate in there. I do think that we have to finesse this measure going forward, because it's important that we ensure the BBC contributes to the creative economy in Scotland.
The other question I was wanting to ask you was, I'm trying to get my head around, what's a non-qualifying independent? The BBC gave us some information about the proportion of spend and hours produced for the network in Scotland between in-house, independent and non-qualifying independent. Can you clarify what that means?
Well, not an expert on this, and I'm looking across at people like John there, but I suspect somebody like STV would be a non-qualifying independent.
Right. So would it also be companies like Mentorn, Lion, Objective, IMG Sports, ITV Productions, 12 Yards?
ITV Productions wouldn't qualify, but right. The others probably would.
Right. So they tend to be companies that are based south of the border, they may have a branch office in Scotland, are they?
No, because I think you can qualify like that. But STV, being a broadcaster, doesn't qualify as an independent producer.
The criteria relates to having a broadcasting arm.
Right. But predominantly that would be south of the border.
STV is a big part of it,
yeah. Yeah, but they don't qualify. Well, what I'm trying to get at is, looking at the figures that BBC Scotland have said, comparing hours and the spend, in-house per hour is 117,000, independents are 56,000 per hour, and non-qualifying independents are £124,000 an hour. Now, I would have thought
that given the pressure on the BBC budget, it would make more sense to spend money either in-house or with independents based in Scotland, given the fact that the costs for non-qualifying independents, which tend to be based south of the border, are substantially higher than in-house and more than double than independents.
Well, it would be better for Scotland, certainly. And I think if you look, again, at the Matchlight submission, which details that you only need to have 5% of spend in Scotland to qualify, it's obviously a system which was needed at the time, but it's time to move on and see that 9%, which feels like a good floor, spent in more productive ways for Scotland.
If I could just add, and I'm not here to speak for the BBC executive, and you have a chance to talk to them next week, I suspect those numbers will be greatly influenced by the genre that each of those categories is producing.
Can I just
very
quickly?
Chicken and Liam.
STV not being able to sell product to BBC because it's a broadcast is a lot of nonsense, isn't it? Because, you know, at the end of the day, it's what
the STV does sell product to the BBC.
But as an independent producer?
Yes, it's just not a qualifying independent producer in terms of the accounting.
I mean, at the end of the day, the point that Donald made is, you know, we're talking about cut, and we should be looking at other areas of how we can generate revenue, and that means embracing the whole market of production. And I just find that anomalous in terms of what we're trying to achieve.
I'm going to bring in Liam. Yeah, Liam.
Yeah. I mean, just for clarity, Convener, in the BBC submission, the footnote to non-qualifying independent, they say non-qualifying independent is defined as a broadcaster owned or employed by a broadcaster, e.g. STV production. So, I mean, they're fairly clear about that. I mean, we can follow that up with them next week, obviously. I think it was going back to something that Donald said in terms of the retention of the revenue and decisions then taken about how that's is spent. I mean, I think there's been fairly hyperbolic examples of what may be denied the viewer or listener in Scotland were we to go down that track. I mean, Doctor Who and EastEnders seem to be the ones, or Strictly seem to be the ones most commonly referred to, and I think it's inconceivable that those would be that any commissioner or editor would not be putting them as part of the mix. But presumably there would be elements of what is currently accessible that would be either more restricted or wouldn't be accessible, and it'd be interesting to try and get a kind of handle on what those are likely to be. What if the output were kind of being force-fed, given that the consumption patterns look broadly similar north and south of the border, even the satisfaction rates kind of vary a little bit. Don't know whether there's a view on what is it that we're getting at the moment that really would need to be pushed aside in order to make room for new content and different content.
I think that goes to the question about what distribution channels, extra distribution channels, does Scotland need or not need. So it brings you to the question of is another TV channel required? Is there demand for one? Is it an interactive service as the BBC paper proposed for Scotland? Because there's one thing sure, there is demand for better representation of the diversity, the cultural diversity of Scotland on our screens. And the invidious choice that the scheduler or the commissioner has got at the moment, both for both the BBC and for STV, is where do you drop from the main schedule in order to put in? So they're faced with this competition the whole time about if you, for example, wanted to schedule the St. Magnus Festival, in which would be exactly the right kind of thing that we should be seeing in our screen in Scotland, would you drop Dad's Army, which is on, you know, at the same time at that time for it? And if Dad's Army is doing 7% share in the network, and you, whatever programme takes its place does a smaller share, then the commissioner scheduler has got a particular kind of balancing act to which isn't easy, which goes down to the root, I think, of the problem, which is that much of this is tactical. So there's too much reliance on tactics and not enough on a strategic approach to developing genres and developing the talent base, if you like, and developing production partnerships with producers in Scotland. We need more content. It's going to demand a way of distributing that content, and that's a decision I would say would be best proposed by BBC management in the fullness of time. But if you were to spend an extra £50 or £100 million worth of programming money in Scotland, you won't find a home for that. So it's not really a case of what should be dropped, but how can you find space to do the additional material.
Come back to a point that Liam made. Is it not the case that in 2010 there was an agreement between the UK and Irish governments which said that RTE1 and RTE2 would be shown in Northern Ireland and BBC1 and BBC2 would be shown in Ireland itself? And we're also in a situation where BBC3 is due to come off the air, I think, in February of this year. So there's actually a channel potentially available. So could we actually have the best of both worlds, where we could get everything on BBC One and BBC Two as it currently stands, which has very little Scottish content, and have BBC Three, which is a Scottish based channel?
Paul?
My understanding is that that was BBC Scotland's submission, that they looked for to take over one of those stations, whether it be BBC Two was flagged up at one stage, or a section of BBC Two, or BBC Three. But certainly one of those stations were looked at as an alternative station. As Donald says, that would then need further expansion in respect to expanded news, but also increased new programmes on music, better drama. So that was part of their submission as part of the £150 million bid. But there was also an additional radio station as well, for which would deal more with having an alternative where you've got music, and then you would have one that would be deal with dialogue. So certainly the ambition is there, and obviously I would be very, very surprised if BBC Scotland management hadn't carried out intensive research into what the audience response would be to such an introduction of a new radio, a new TV station. I think it would almost certainly have carried out that type of research. Don't think it's in the public arena. I think it's probably in someone's desk. Could be right, could be wrong. But I'd be surprised if that hadn't been carried out. And I think that they probably found that, to back up their submission, that they have figures to show that the Scottish public would welcome such an expansion.
Can somebody tell me what happened to this blueprint? What happened to the blueprint? I mean, you know, it was a BBC Scotland, I presume, management team proposal that went to BBC London. What happened to it?
Kicked into the long grass with the phrase that we were told. Now, what's happened since then is that the BBC management team, under various pressure from the workforce, I think from other aspects, some sort of cross-party political support that the joint unions asked for, have gone back and asked for negotiations to open up, and I understand that there is a much reduced improvement in some of the funding going to be coming forward over the next short period. So you will see a response from Tony Hall over the next few weeks, I think, but it will be on a much more minimal content in respect to comparison with the original submission.
So it's just been removed. It's off the table. Is that
initially it was, but I believe there's now further negotiations now taking place to restore a small part of it.
I'm sure we'll ask Tony next week about that. Can I ask directly Janet a question about your submission, Janet, from Creative Scotland? You say in it, the BBC Studios proposal risks driving the focus and emphasis of relationships further towards London to the detriment of the Scottish sector. It's in your submission. What do you mean by that, and what are the risks that you're talking about?
Well, we're still interrogating exactly what the proposition is in relation to BBC Studios. So I think it's important to say we don't understand it fully yet, but we think that opening up competition will risk Scottish indies to an extent that could create a worse situation than we've got now with quotas. Been interested from John to see what he says about that. So we think that it's important that we have a dialogue with the BBC around that. The positive side is that in the BBC's proposition, it clearly says that's recognised, and there's a willingness to have that conversation to really look at how independent production, local production in Scotland can be protected in that wider context. So I think the door's open to have a conversation about that. I think we're flagging here that we need to pursue that along with everybody else who has an interest.
Yeah, you also talk about, again, to quote, the recalibration of the out-of-London quota system. What do you mean by, what would that look like, that recalibration?
We haven't worked it out yet. But what we're saying is that the current system of quotas has led to lift and shift. Yes, of course, it's brought work to cast and crew and other practitioners, and that's really important. But what it hasn't done is contribute to organic development and growth of the independent production centre in Scotland in the way that we think it could achieve. And we need to move into a different frame if we're going to be able to drive the creative industries and respond to the talent that clearly does exist here and needs to be given the opportunity to be made more meaningful. Yes. So in recalibrating that's classic jargon, I'll acknowledge that. Clearly something needs to be done to get us to a better position. But the only way that we'll do that is through proper dialogue with the BBC and to work it out together. I think I'm heartwarmed by the fact that a lot of the things that were discussed, certainly in the earlier panel and now, it seems to me, are things that are being recognised by the BBC, but what hasn't been put in place is a set of actions that can deliver on turning things around into a more positive place. And it feels, although I haven't been here for as long as many around the table, that this is a conversation that's been had for many, many years, and the sticking point has always been on proper joined-up solutions that work, and it feels as if that's where we've got to be really assertive and determined now.
I think, as we heard earlier, it was recognised in 1951.
Exactly.
Recognition of the problem has never been the issue. Yeah. It seems to be the implementation of solution that's been been the issue. Can I bring in Paul? You know, I don't know whether, Paul, you have an issue on this, or some comments on the BBC Studios issue.
Yes, and I'm not convinced that the BBC has yet seen the solution, or certainly one that we're looking for, given its proposals on BBC Studios. I mean, as we see it, there are two options if the proposal on BBC Studios goes ahead. Either the BBC Studios virtually kills off the independent sector, particularly in Scotland, because it would be a commercial animal competing for business out there, or the more likely scenario is that, as has been the way with other BBC ventures down this road, it kills itself off, and we end up losing the valuable balance we have at the minute. BBC Resources was lauded in exactly the same way as BBC Studios is now being done. BBC Technology was lauded in exactly the same way as BBC Studios are doing now. Both of them abysmal failures and very quickly led to the loss of many thousands of jobs and rising costs to the BBC from having to buy in the services that it used to provide in-house. There is a possibility that it could use its economies of scale to the huge detriment of the independent sector. I think the smart money would be more than the fact that it would suffer a short and miserable life and disappear. But in disappearing, we would then lose some of the key elements that the BBC is obliged to deliver as part of its charter. Things like training for the industry, things like delivering quality public service content. We have a good partnership at the minute, which could be greatly improved on in Scotland. There are a lot of benefits both ways between the independent sector and the BBC. If BBC Studios goes ahead and falls apart, that will ultimately have a huge damaging effect on the sector. PACT has recognised, the independent sector has recognised in various submissions to both Scotland and Westminster, that when the BBC spends money on productions, organisations like Sky and ITV match that spending to compete with the BBC. When the BBC doesn't spend the money, they don't spend the money. And that affects the independent sector just as much as any other area. So the BBC Studio proposals is fraught with danger. And again, I'm sorry for those people who feel we keep talking about cut, 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 but when the BBC is facing a loss of a fifth of its budget, then, you know, I'd like to know where the money is coming from that is going to allow us to expand the industry.
Check.
Yeah, I thought a point about economies of scale earlier on. Why, in that circumstance, is it not possible to work in partnership with the independent producers? Again, we were talking about this, you know, sectorisation of the BBC, mm-hmm. instead of being part of an overall, you know, market provider. Why can't they work, in your opinion, in partnership?
If they go into the BBC Studios proposal, yes. Because essentially it becomes a commercial company that's competing against the independent sector.
Yes, but many commercial companies subcontract or work in partnerships with other providers, suppliers, to their particular output.
It kind of defeats the purpose of setting up the commercial. You know, they'll want the work instead of it going to the independent sector.
Oh, I don't think it does.
Sky and ITV are exactly the same. Their production arms don't lie idle, where work goes to the production sector, independent sector.
Right, it depends on the will of the management.
Okay, can I? You'll all have read the submission we received from Matchlight about Lift and Shift and how the percentages set out by Ofcom could operate. They provided an example of how one particular company operating out of Bristol would be able to meet the rules as a Scottish production, but effectively only 5% was actually spent in Scotland. Can I have people's thoughts about that, whether they believe that's a genuine example of what could happen, can happen, or does happen? John?
I think it probably was a genuine example. I think that's the position from which we need to move on from. That 9% spent properly from Scotland would be really valuable to the creative economy. And I'd love to see the audit committee at the Scottish Parliament looking at BBC Scotland's contribution to the creative economy in the wider sense, because it's got the biggest budget that there is for our creative economy. The figures on Lift and Shift are, if you look at the programmes that are being made on the whole for entertainment or for daytime, it should be seen as part of a staging post to reaching a better place, I think.
Okay, thank you. Liam?
I think that's an entirely reasonable position. It's just, for fairness, we've had Matchlight, who used it as an illustrative example, made clear that they weren't talking about a specific example. And the BBC have said, if our legal team feel that the spirit of the Ofcom definition is not being met by any particular title, then that programme will be rejected for inclusion as a Scottish title. This has happened on a number of past occasions. I think it would be helpful for us, notwithstanding, I think, the place we want to get to, which is probably akin to what John was suggesting there, if we had examples of Lift and Shifts, which clearly are driving a coach and horses through the Ofcom definitions, and where BBC is not being honest to what it said in its evidence. And likewise from the BBC, we need evidence of where I think they've rejected propositions as Scottish titles on the basis that they have not honoured the spirit, even if they've honoured the letter of that definition.
Okay, thank you. Mark.
Thanks, Kevina. I had a couple of questions that are on a similar line to the ones I posed to the previous panel around how the BBC meet the needs of the Scottish audience. And particularly, I'd like to ask, firstly, Bill from the Audience Council about how well you feel that the BBC reflects the diversity of the UK and particularly Scotland.
Let me reflect back on firstly how we gather the evidence and then what I think audiences think of that. The BBC Trust spends a lot of time speaking to audiences directly, speaking to quite a large online panel that we have that is divided so there is a slightly larger sample in Scotland than the numbers would normally allow. And we do a bunch of engagement work as trustees, and the volunteer members of the Audience Council do that. We go around and speak to audiences throughout Scotland. So we form an opinion based on all our daily lives, plus quite a significant body of evidence. As with anything in the BBC, there isn't a single view. There are 5 million different views of the BBC in Scotland, and that's part of the challenge here. And there are people who will tell us that the BBC is perfect as it is. I suppose there is a recurring theme which you can read in the Audience Council annual review of last year, that more and more people believe the BBC could do a better job of reflecting the diversity of certainly Scotland. And I think you could argue it's probably reflected elsewhere in the UK. There are other parts of the UK, north of England, for example, where they maybe don't think they're reflected. So it's a challenge when there are many, many different parts of the UK, many different interests all vying for attention on a budget that's decreasing all the time. So I think that it's an area that going forward, whatever regulatory body looks after the BBC in the future needs to pay very close attention to ensuring that the BBC is a broadcaster for the whole of the UK.
And when that research work is carried out, how's that presented to BBC managers? Is that presented as a Scotland-wide opinion, or how are the regional variances in Scotland then an opinion and demand for content then presented to BBC management so that they can take the decisions?
So I should, of course, have said that the BBC executive themselves, outside of the trust process, do their own audience research. Audience input comes in through a lot of different channels. Complaints is a mechanism by which you can pick up opinions. How is that presented? Well, the trust engages with the BBC executive on a regular basis, formally and informally. So there is a sharing of data in terms of what audiences are saying. To speak to a question or a comment that was raised in the earlier session about the direction through which feedback from Audience Council Scotland makes it to the executive in Scotland. I think there was a comment from the Ofcom report earlier. It's true on paper that the route through which this model of feedback operates, the Audience Council is an advisory body to the BBC Trust through me. And the BBC Trust engages with the executive, and the executive will then engage with the wider executive team. So that's on paper how it operates. In practice, we meet with the BBC Scotland executive team on an approximately monthly basis, and there's an informal and quite direct dialogue between the two parts of the governance structure. And I think that's actually reasonably effective. It's not a direct governance mechanism. But it helps us exchange some views, understand some of the reasons perhaps that the executive in Scotland have had to do things a certain way, and it helps Audience Council, who are a group of 11 passionate volunteers, very, very keen in public service broadcasting, to express their views. So there are a number of mechanisms through which that information is transferred, but I don't believe either of us sit on information.
Gordon?
Very last question. Can you tell us the size of the panel that represents Scotland in terms of, I better read this out to get it right, Broadcasters Audience Research Board. There are 5,100 homes across the whole of the UK. How many of them are in Scotland that determines how well the BBC are doing? And secondly, what is the trust levels in the BBC and what direction have they been heading since the late 1990s?
So, to answer, in short, I don't know the answer to your first question, but we can certainly get it to you. And if we don't get it to you, then if we don't, I'm sure the executive can answer that because those are executive numbers. Trust levels in the BBC fluctuate, and there have been moments where trust has declined quite significantly. When the BBC was hit with a number of scandals, trust declined. The overall trend, I think, in all broadcasters and news outlets is I think audiences are becoming slightly more wise to the way that the media operates. So I think there's an ongoing challenge in terms of how impartiality is presented and so on.
Would I be right in saying that in the late 90s all of the four nations of the UK were all around about 60-65%? They've all come down, but England's come down from 65-61% and Scotland's come down from 62-48%.
Scotland is, I think I'm right in saying, at the bottom end of the league table of trust at the moment, yes.
Thanks.
That's quite a difference, though. The bottom end doesn't suggest quite the figures that Gordon...
I think the trust has fallen across all the nations. I think I'm right in saying that, but we can certainly get that data to you. But as we said, going right back to the top of the meeting, I said, as chair of the Audience Council here, One of the issues for the BBC in Scotland is that it is perceived and appreciated less than it appears to be in other parts of the UK. And the data that Gordon's speaking about is simply data that points us to that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can I thank all of you for coming along here today and giving your time to the committee? Obviously, it's a very important time for both the BBC in Scotland, the BBC across the UK, and the creative sector more generally. Next week we have BBC executives in front of the committee, as well as the Cabinet Secretary. So I very much look forward to, and the BBC Trust, I should say. And I look forward to hearing from them. The committee will provide a report on its thinking after that. And as I think Mary mentioned earlier, we are hoping to have a debate in the Chamber sometime, certainly obviously before Parliament dissolves. This is obviously an extremely important matter. If you have any further thoughts or comments you want to make, please don't hesitate to send them in to us, and we'll be very grateful to receive them. So thank you very much, and with that, I close the meeting.